Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 3427 in the name of Michael Russell, protecting Scotland's interest in negotiating our future relationship with Europe. Can I invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now? I call on Fiona Hislop to speak to and move the motion in the name of Michael Russell, Cabinet Secretary, 15 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Presiding Officer, I move the motion in Michael Russell's name. I understand the front bench have been advised that he's regrettably unable to attend today. Presiding Officer, almost 7 months since the EU referendum in which Scotland voted emphatically to remain in the European Union whilst England and Wales voted to leave, the Prime Minister has today announced as ending the UK involvement in the European project in the hardest and most complete way possible. We think this is the wrong decision for the UK as a whole and indicates that the type of country the Conservatives want is a race to the bottom, sacrificing consumer, environmental and workers' rights for the price of deregulation, low wages and low taxes. But the Scottish Government and the Scottish people, as indicated in poll after poll, have a different view. We have to find a way forward that honours the democratic demand of the nation to maintain our relationship with our European friends and neighbours. We are realistic, and the proposals we have set out are pragmatic, recognising that the UK is leaving the EU and a compromise in the Scottish national interest. And it reflects the interests of this Parliament. This Parliament on the 28th of June voted 92-0 to mandate the Scottish Government to explore options for protecting Scotland's relationship with the EU, Scotland's place in the single market, and the social, employment and economic benefits that come from that. And although there was a division during the debate, it was clear that even those who did not support the government's motion in its entirety were of one mind about certain key issues. There was, for example, unanimous support for EU nationals in Scotland, and today I welcome the sentiments behind the amendment to the motion for this debate from Ross Grier. I would reiterate that EU nationals are and will remain welcome in Scotland and that their futures should not be used as part of a negotiation strategy by the UK government. And in June, there was also agreement about the importance of the single market. For example, Ruth Davidson, on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives, tabled an amendment which she said, and I quote, makes it clear that we want to protect and maximise Scotland's place in Europe, the continent, and in the European single market. Indeed, since then, Ruth Davidson has gone further. On June the 30th, she said, and I quote, I think that we need to agree some first principles for the talks. Retaining our place in the single market should be the overriding priority. And she told the BBC a few days later that she wanted to stay in the single market, and I quote, even if a consequence of that is maintaining free movement of labour. Kezia Dugdale, on behalf of Scottish Labour, agreed that, and I quote, all options for protecting Scotland's place in the single market must be explored. Patrick Harvey and Willie Rennie were also amongst voices from across the chamber who wished to see the government explore all the options open to us within the context of the single market. Now, Scotland's place in Europe...
Mike Rumbles.
We were also assured in that very debate that this issue was emphatically, and those were the words that were used, emphatically not about a Scottish independence referendum. And that's why you had our
Cabinet
that's
Secretary.
Why you had our that's why, if I may speak, that's why you had our support.
Cabinet Secretary.
And I can reassure the member, if he has taken the trouble to read this document, Scotland's place in Europe, this is a compromise. It is not about independence, and neither is it about continued EU membership. But it is the UK government that is driving the debate to the hard right of the Conservatives, shaping a country that I think many people are questioning, do they want to continue with on the terms of Theresa May? But the ball is firmly in her court. Scotland's Place in Europe was published on the 20th of December. It delivered the mandate that we were required to do by this Parliament. It's the first detailed plan to be published by any government in any part of the UK to deal with the implications of the UK leaving the European Union. And today's debate gives us, as a Parliament, speaking for our nation, to take those plans a step further. On Thursday, the Scottish Government will make a presentation about these plans to the JMC European Negotiation Committee. And it is, of course, proper that this this Parliament should give its view to them in advance of that discussion in London. The Prime Minister was explicit today in stressing that this paper is still to be considered by the UK Government. And as the First Minister highlighted to the Chamber on the launch of our publication, these proposals represent a significant compromise on behalf of the Scottish Government, and they are put forward in good faith. And we are pleased that this point has been recognised and accepted by so many in Scotland. For example, by Professor Sir David Edwards, Scottish lawyer and academic and former judge of the Court of Justice of the European Communities, who said that he believes that the Scottish Government is right to urge the UK Government to maintain the UK's position within the single market, the customs union and the various forms of security and police cooperation. That is the primary proposal, and I believe it merits the widest support across the political spectrum. Indeed.
Stuart Stevenson.
Cabinet Secretary will be aware that the Prime Minister made a speech this morning and discussed the disbenefits to Europe in barriers to trade from Europe to the UK, in particular highlighting the plight of Spanish fishermen who might not get access to the UK market, while saying not a single word about Scottish and English fishermen and the detriments they might suffer in getting their products to the EU. Disgraceful, is it not?
Cabinet Secretary.
And that is the nub of the issue. How do we make sure that we do not repeat the situation where, and I raised this issue only yesterday in Brussels with UK officials, never again should we allow the UK government to see Scottish fishermen and Scottish fishing as expendable. Yeah, yeah. In developing our paper, the Scottish Government has listened carefully to the many communities across and outside Scotland in order that we might understand and respect the wide range of views, including those from who voted to leave the EU. And we've engaged positively in the Joint Ministerial Committee, as well as the British Irish Council, a wide range of bilateral, multilateral official meetings. We've worked with other devolved administrations, with London, Gibraltar and the Crown Dependencies. And there's also been engagement at diplomatic or government level with every one of the remaining 27 member states of the EU, as well as an exhaustive range of meetings with think tanks, academics, businesses, representative bodies and individuals in Scotland and other places too. Yesterday, I presented our proposals to European partners in Brussels. I held a constructive meeting with the Belgian Vice Prime Minister and Minister of Foreign and European Affairs, Didier Reynders. And I also ensured that I had engagements with others. And I also met with Sir Tim Barrow, the UK's new permanent representative to the European Union. And I made the point about fishing in particular. I outlined our expectation following commitments made by the Prime Minister, repeated again today, that Scotland will be fully engaged in the process to agree a UK-wide approach to Brexit in advance of triggering of Article 50. And I'm grateful to all of those who've offered their views during our meetings and engagements, including those in the Chamber today. And I'm also grateful for the Standing Council for its advice and guidance and its input to the development of our paper. But central to our proposition is the belief that short of EU membership, full membership of the single market and customs union is the best outcome, not just for Scotland, but the whole of the UK. And that membership can be secured by UK membership of EFTA and the European Economic Area. And it is disappointing to see that prospect for the UK as a whole being rejected by the Prime Minister today, but we will continue to work with everyone across the political spectrum to take forward the arguments of a differentiated option for Scotland within the UK negotiating position. Indeed.
Adam Tompkins.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. She mentioned a few moments ago the First Minister's Standing Council on Europe. Charles Grant is a member of that Standing Council, and he has said on the point that the Cabinet Secretary is addressing right now that it would be legally, politically and technically extremely difficult, his words, not mine, for Scotland to stay in the single market if the UK as a whole does not. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree?
It will be extremely difficult to ensure that the economy and society of Scotland and the UK can survive and prosper and flourish under the terms of what the UK government has provided today. But in relation to Charles Grant, we agree, we actually say in the document, we know this is challenging, we understand the challenges within that. I was talking to many eminent experts only yesterday in Brussels about these issues, but everybody has said, as did Charles Grant, this is a considered piece of work. There are challenges within it. It's technically and legal possible, but there are challenges and changes that would have to take place, and we acknowledge that fully in the document, and have actually been complimented for facing up to the challenges that we might have. We've also highlighted the ways that we can keep Scotland in the single market while continuing to protect free trade from across the rest of the UK, as well as safeguarding the existing powers of this Parliament and significantly expanding devolution in order to mitigate the damage that will be done by Brexit. And it's difficult to overstate the importance of Scotland's continuing membership of the single market. It's central to the health of our economy and our prosperity as a nation, enabling Scottish exporters to be inside the world's largest single market, enabling our citizens to buy goods and services free from import tax and barriers. And the single market has removed barriers to trade and opened Scotland to a market of over 500 million people and 21 million small and medium-sized enterprises. It is 8 times the size of the UK market alone. And businesses selling in the EU have unrestricted access to these consumers, helping them to stay competitive. And as a result, Scotland's exports to the EU are now worth more than £11.6 billion a year, or 42% of the country's total international exports.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. You said earlier that this document has nothing to do with independence, but the foreword in this document contains 11 references to independence. And you mentioned the importance of the European single market. Do you think the European single market is more important than the market with the rest of the UK that accounts for 65% of our trade?
Cabinet Secretary.
We're quite clear, it's not an either or, it's a both and. We want to make sure we've got single market access to the EU and continue with the United Kingdom. That's what's in the document. And we've made it quite clear that our preferred option was the UK as a whole to remain in the single market. We've also then set out the differentiated option we're going to have to pursue just now. But we're also quite clear, if we can't achieve the type of results that we want to see and the requirements of the Scottish people, then we have to make sure that independence is still on the table. If required. Now, we've been quite open about this and we've been quite transparent, but we would not be spending the time and energy and effort to be making sure there's a solution for the people of Scotland in the national interest with all the activity that I set out. Our proposals state that Scotland should follow the UK position on a customs union. If the UK is out, Scotland would be out. It's also a market, the single market, in which considerable potential remains to be unlocked, and new opportunities to increase our trade and cooperation will emerge. New market opportunities will arise. The digital economy, services sector, energy, retail, green economy, and others. And when the UK becomes poorer as a result of Brexit, and Brexit has not happened yet, particularly if there is a hard Brexit, as looks as will be the case from today's announcement, then taking advantage of the growing European market will become even more important for Scotland. And membership of the European single market also involves implementing a range of measures designed to further the rights and the interests of working people, protect and advance social and environmental interests, and address wider societal changes and challenges such as climate change by collaborative research and collective action. And whilst our key proposal is for the UK as a whole to retain membership of the single market and customs union, we of course have had to put in place plans and intentions for the situation announced today by the Prime Minister, who has chosen to listen to the isolationist Tory Brexiteers and take the path that leads to the hardest of withdrawals. They want to prioritise cutting immigration and the rejection of the European Court over the financial, employment, social and cultural interests of Scotland. But more than that, they are putting the interests of the right wing of the Tory party over the interests of the people of Scotland. And our paper explores the ways by which we might secure a differentiated option for Scotland, one which keeps Scotland in the single market by means of continued membership of the European Economic Area. And this strategic objective represents a compromise from the Scottish Government. It falls short of what we consider to be the best option for Scotland and the UK, which it remains full EU membership. However, the Scottish Government is prepared, as the First Minister has made clear, to offer such a compromise in the national interest in the hope of gaining consensus in Scotland and agreement in the UK to the practical position we've set out. I'm sorry, I need to make progress. In this paper, we reiterate our position that we've held for a long time, that just as UK-wide free movement and free trade could, should and would continue if Scotland became independent in the way that the UK Government intends that free trade and free movement between the UK and the Republic of Ireland Ireland will continue after Brexit. So we are making plans to secure for Scotland explicitly and sincerely the benefits of the European single market, in addition to, not instead of, free trade and free movement across the UK. And in September, David Davis, the UK Secretary of State for leaving the European Union, went to Dublin and told business people there, Ireland will not have to choose between having a strong commitment to the EU or to the UK. It can and should have both. And as we've seen through its approach to Nissan last October, the UK government is all okay and ready to have a flexible Brexit deal and in relation to different sectors of the economy. Why should that flexibility not provide to distinctive geographical areas? Now, we know that there are challenges in what we're proposing, but they can be secured if there's a political will to do so. We want our discussions with the UK to succeed. That has been our message quite clearly in our discussions with the UK government. But if our attempts at agreeing a compromise are rejected, then it is vital that we continue to have other options available to us, including that of a referendum on independence. If the hard right of the Tory party, which is driving the UK debate, can drag Scotland not only out of the EU, but out of the single market as well, then it will start to believe it can do anything to Scotland and get away with it. So finally, this paper sets out why Scotland must have necessary powers to protect democratic, economic, solidarity, social protection and influence issues on leaving the EU. The EU is a major source of rights, and we've debated already in this Parliament. The next steps, presiding officer, is that we take forward those discussions with the UK government. Theresa May repeated today that Scotland should be fully engaged in the Brexit process. The next meeting of the JMCN is on Thursday. Presiding officer, Scotland will not be silenced by a right-wing Tory government, which is intent on riding roughshod over our vital national interests.
And Cabinet Secretary is in her last minute.
Scotland will not be silenced by a right-wing Tory government, which is intent on riding roughshod over our vital national interests and the democratic voice of the Scottish people. It's time to stand up for the interests of Scotland.
Thank you very much. I call on Dean Lockhart to speak to and move Amendment 3427.3. 11 minutes or thereabout, please, Mr Lockhart.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I would like to start by recognising the contribution to the EU debate provided by the Scottish Government's paper on Scotland's place in Europe. I would also like to highlight the powerful speech delivered by the Prime Minister this morning, which provides us with much greater clarity on the UK's future relationship with the EU, something I will return to later. Looking first at the SNP's proposal for a differentiated relationship for Scotland with the EU, the central recommendation is that Scotland maintains continued membership of the EEA and the European single market. The so-called Norway option is one example of how this might be achieved. The report itself acknowledges that this proposal raises technical, legal and political complexities and will require the express agreement of all 27 EU member states. Initial reactions to the SNP's proposals have raised some serious concerns. Members of the First Minister's own Standing Council of Experts have said their proposals would be highly unlikely and extremely difficult to implement. We share these concerns. On this side of the chamber, we encourage the Scottish Government to work closely with the rest of the UK and use the full strength of the UK's bargaining position to get the very best deal for Scotland. Presiding Officer, I will first set out the advantages of taking this UK-wide approach to the negotiations before considering the differentiated approach proposed by the SNP. Under the UK-wide approach, our combined objective, as set out by the Prime Minister this morning, is to pursue a bold and ambitious free trade agreement with the EU in order to allow for the freest possible trade in goods and services. Let me highlight to the members, all European countries outside of the EU have tariff-free access to the EU single market under free trade agreements, with the exception of Belarus. The Prime Minister also highlighted today a number of other significant objectives which will address... In a second, I will. Prime Minister also raised a number of other significant objectives which will address issues raised by various parties. First of all, the guarantees of rights of EU nationals in Britain as early as possible as part of the negotiations, the protection of workers' rights currently enshrined in EU law, new trade agreements with the rest of the world through a new and bespoke arrangement with the European Customs Union, and a smooth, orderly Brexit with a phased process of implementation, with a final EU deal to be agreed by the UK Parliament.
Mr. Crawford.
Dean Lockhart could tell us just how many countries within the European Union would need to agree a free trade agreement between the United Kingdom and the European Union. Is it not 27?
Mr. Lockhart.
It is 27, Mr. Crawford, and we would have a very strong bargaining position because the EU... The EU exports more to the UK than vice versa. And I'll come on to this. The EU chief negotiator has already said they want access to the City of London and the UK as a financial hub. And I'll come on to that later. Now, Presiding Officer, Deputy Presiding Officer, the market reaction to these ambitious plans...
I'd like to hear Mr. Lockhart, please.
Thank you. The market reaction to these ambitious plans has seen the pound appreciate by 2.5%, showing faith in this new vision for the negotiations. Given these ambitious objectives announced by the Prime Minister for the UK to be a leading global free trading nation, it is now clear that Scotland will be in a much stronger position if it negotiates together with the UK. For example, I will a bit later, let me make some progress. For example, together we represent the financial hubs of London, Edinburgh and Glasgow. The chief negotiator of the EU, as I said to Mr. Crawford, has recently recognised that financial stability will be a critical factor for an increasingly fragile Eurozone. It will therefore be vital as part of the negotiations for the EU to continue to have free access to global funding from the City of London, as well as Edinburgh and Glasgow, as the UK remains the centre for global capital markets. A UK-wide approach would, in a second, a UK-wide approach would also avoid creating potential barriers to trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK, ensuring free access to Scotland's vital domestic market, which accounts for 65% of our trade, compared to the EU single market, which only accounts for 15% of our trade. Many commentators have warned that free trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK would end if one country was in the single market and the other was not. On that point, Charles Grant, one of the First Minister's Standing Council of Experts, has said it is extremely difficult for Scotland to stay in the single market if the UK as a whole does not. There would have to be one set of business regulations applying to England and another set applying to Scotland. Please go ahead.
Ash Denham.
I'm very interested in the member's opinion of this idea about renegotiating these bilateral trade agreements. Most experts are expressing the time frame on that would be about 10 years. So are the Conservatives happy to preside over 10 years of lost trade?
Mr. Lockhart.
There are various ways of achieving that. The UK could, for example, the UK could accede to existing arrangements which are in place. So that's all part of the negotiation. But I'm very confident, unlike some others, that we have a strong position.
Quite right.
Just getting back to this point about the priority being our domestic market with the rest of the UK, the head of Scottish Engineering has warned that having two regulatory systems would damage trading with the UK, our largest market, something that we want to avoid through the differentiated approach proposed by the SNP. A UK-wide approach would also mean that Scotland could fully participate in new trade deals entered into by the UK after Brexit. Our single largest international trading country is the United States. Trade levels with the US have doubled in the past decade. Scotland exports more to the US than it does to Germany and France combined. Exports to the EU have declined in recent years. Exports to the rest of the world have increased from 16% to 20%. So there are significant benefits to be derived from entering into new trade agreements with the likes of China and India, as recommended by the Scotch Whisky Association. And that is something Scotland can benefit, but only as a UK-wide negotiation with the European Union. So given all of these opportunities, I would encourage the Scottish Government to work together with the UK Government to get the very best deal for the people of Scotland. Presiding Officer, turning now to the differentiated approach.
Gillian Martin.
I would like to know what reference the Prime Minister made to companies using the UK as a tax haven, as mentioned by the Chancellor, Philip Hammond, on Sunday. And if she didn't make a reference to that, can you answer as to why the UK public should think that that's in their interest and a boost for the UK?
Mr. Lockhart.
I think as part of the negotiations, you'll see a lot of positioning by different people. That was speculation as a possible outcome.
Right, right.
Don't see it being part of it.
Right, right.
Presiding Officer, turning now to the differentiated approach proposed in the SNP's paper, there are a number of constitutional, economic, practical and legal problems surrounding the SNP proposals. Constitutionally, the proposal for a Norway-style arrangement would require the consent of all four existing EFTA members, as well as the other 27 EU states. In addition, Article 56 of the EFTA Convention provides that only nation states can become members, meaning that Scotland would have to first become independent before it could apply to EFTA. No, I've done enough at this stage, thank you. Reflecting this constitutional background, the head of the Norwegian delegation to EFTA has made it clear. To enter the EEA agreement, a nation has to be either a member of the EU or EFTA. To become a member of EFTA, Scotland would have to first leave the UK. His words, not mine. In addition, a leading Spanish MEP has commented that...
It's true.
If you don't like the message, that's probably why you're not listening.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
A leading Spanish MEP has commented that we are not going to accept Scotland in the single market without the rest of the UK. Economically, the SNP proposals run the real risk of creating an economic or customs border between Scotland and the rest of the UK and requiring business in Scotland to follow two regulatory systems. Yep. Professor Michael Keating has warned that free trade between Scotland and the rest of the UK would end if one country was in the EU single market and the other was not. On a practical level, let me refer you to members of the First Minister's own Standing Council of Experts, because the First Minister said she would follow their advice every step of the way. Well, perhaps you might want to hear their advice that their proposal is highly unlikely. Finally, legally, the proposals would see Scotland having no influence whatsoever over its legal and trading framework, and directly contradicts the First Minister's own five Brexit tests, including making sure that we don't just have to abide by the rules of the single market, but we also have a say in shaping them. That would not be the case. Presiding Officer, following the announcement by the Prime Minister today, it is now clearer than ever that Scotland's best interests will be served by following a UK-wide approach to negotiating our future with Europe.
Yeah.
Let me conclude, Presiding Officer. Our amendment to the government motion today calls on the SNP...
I would like to hear Mr Lockhart, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. So would I. No, thank you. Our amendment to the government motion today calls on the SNP to act in the best interest of the people of Scotland as a whole and to stop using the outcome of the EU referendum to campaign for independence. In the foreword to this paper, Scotland's Place in Europe, supposedly a document about Europe, there are 11 separate references to independence, as well as the First Minister's repeated reference to Scotland being independent within Europe as being the preferred option. Yet again, the SNP continues to defy economic logic by constantly campaigning to leave our domestic UK trading market, representing 65% of our business, to maintain membership of a European single market that accounts for only 15%. A clear majority of people in Scotland do not want another independence referendum, do not want to join the Eurozone, the Schengen area, and do not want to be part and subject to the monetary and fiscal policies of the European Central Bank. It is time for the SNP to stop using this paper as a European version of the White Paper on Independence, listen to the people of Scotland, and rule out another damaging independence referendum. I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr Lockhart. Call on Lewis MacDonald to speak to and move amendment 3427.1, 8 minutes or thereabouts, Mr MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. We start the new year as we ended the old, debating Scotland's future relationship with Europe and what it means for Scotland's place in the United Kingdom. Things have changed, of course, not just since the Scottish Government published Scotland's Place in Europe in December, but indeed in the course of the last few hours. The premise that the best option is for the UK not to leave the single market in the first place is the starting point of this paper. But as we have heard, it has been dismissed altogether today by Theresa May. And the Scottish Government has outlined its own Plan B, recognising the risk of just such a position being taken. And that, of course, is central to our debate this afternoon. But we also need to understand what the Prime Minister said today. She appeared to say three things. No to the single market, yes to transitional arrangements, and on the customs union, don't know. Her government has still not reached a clear position on that critical matter. There was little evidence of a willingness to consider different outcomes on the single market for different parts of the UK. But the Prime Minister has given undertakings to consider proposals from the Scottish Government, and that pledge should be honoured. Our starting point in this debate is that we acknowledge the benefits that Scotland and Britain have derived from membership of the European single market. But we know that the single market of the United Kingdom is even more important to our vital interests. The Scottish Government has proposed that Scotland can retain the benefits of one without sacrificing the other. But ministers, I hope, recognise that retaining our place in the single market does not mean the status quo. It cannot mean full membership of the single market if the UK Parliament endorses what Theresa May had to say today. Our place in future, as we argued last time we debated the single market, has to mean the most unfettered access to that market that can be achieved in the context of the decisions of the United Kingdom as a whole. But in that context, ministers can and should continue to seek ways to protect Scotland's vital interests, working with others across the United Kingdom who are also seeking to make the best of the current circumstances. Our Labour colleagues in Wales, like us, believe that access to the single market is vitally important to jobs and prosperity, and that there is scope for the Scottish and Welsh governments to work together in their approach to discussions in the Joint Ministerial Committee and elsewhere. The Mayor of London is strongly focused on the issue of freedom of movement, so again there is scope for working together to achieve vital economic and social objectives for both London and Scotland. And so we welcome the emphasis in today's government motion on the issue of free movement of workers, and we value the single market for the rights it gives to citizens as well as for access for business. Of course.
Cabinet Secretary.
I appreciate the points the member is making, and clearly in terms of the single market, it's not just the economic trade, it's the four aspects, and the point about freedom of movement is also, and also about the regulations, is the protection of workers' rights, which really is at risk unless we ensure that we can comply and ensure that they're in the best interest of the people of Scotland going forward. Is that a point that the member agrees with?
Absolutely, and workers' rights are certainly central to our approach and among the key benefits that we recognise and identify from the positive experience, if you like, of the European experience, along, of course, with jobs and business. The government's motion also says that in the event that the UK opts to leave the single market, alternative approaches within the UK should be sought, and we welcome that to enable Scotland to retain its place. We welcome that emphasis. Seeking alternatives within the UK is clearly different from seeking alternatives to the UK, and we remain wholly opposed to any options which would sacrifice access to the British single market in favour of the European one, but we are in favour of exploring alternatives which do not. We want the Scottish Government to go and talk to UK ministers about their paper on alternatives within the UK, and we want UK ministers
Mr.
to
Tompkins.
Mr. MacDonald, for giving way. And on that point, I wonder if the member agrees with something that the Prime Minister said in her speech earlier on today, where she said that it must be one of the United Kingdom's guiding principles that no new barriers are created to living and doing business within our own union of nations. Is that a position which is with which Scottish Labour now agree or disagree?
Mr. MacDonald.
It's certainly the case that we want to create as few new barriers to movement and to doing business as possible. First, and certainly within the United Kingdom, as I have said, that is our starting point. But clearly, barriers created within Europe equally damage our vital economic and social interests, and that is also part of our perspective. But of course, it's true to say that this government has to talk to the UK government in order for the proposals in this paper to be taken forward. Access to the European Economic Area through membership of EFTA for Scotland alone would require support both from the UK government and from EFTA member states. It is also hard to see how it would be possible to maintain a customs union across the UK if part of the UK was in the European single market and part was not. That again is something that has to be addressed. Because of course, if ultimately the UK does leave the single market and the European customs union, it will then seek to negotiate bilateral trade deals with other countries, and there would therefore soon be a divergence between trade deals entered into by the UK and those to which member states of EFTA and the EEA are already committed, either directly or as a consequence of the relationship with the European Union. Certainly.
Mr. McKee.
I'm aware, of course, that Norway, whilst in the single market with the European Union, is outside the customs union and is therefore not subject to external deals negotiated on behalf of the European Union.
Mr. MacDonald.
I'm very aware of that. The critical challenge for the government in promoting and making the case for their paper or their plan B is the proposition around the customs union of the United Kingdom, although I completely take the point that Mr. McKee makes about the significance of the European customs union as well. But even if the UK agreed to support a special arrangement for Scotland, there would clearly be the risk of a direct conflict between membership of EFTA for a part of the UK and the UK-wide customs union, because there are provisions in relation to trade that apply there as well. And Fiona Hislop summed up the Scottish Government approach to the customs union today, and I think I paraphrase her fairly, that essentially is to shadow whatever decision on a customs union the Conservative government ultimately makes. And Mrs. May's clear rejection of the single market today was in marked contrast with her uncertainty about the right way forward on tariffs and trade. And that's little wonder. If businesses in every sector of the economy can see the risk to export and jobs from tariff barriers between Britain and Europe of exactly the kind Professor Tompkins referred to, you would expect government ministers to see that too. That uncertainty about the options of signing or leaving the customs union in Europe does offer room for manoeuvre, which should be taken. Although I do believe that ministers need to be realistic about the relationship between membership of the single market and membership of the UK customs union. Today is also the right time to look beyond the triggering of Article 50. That is the purpose of our amendment today. If the UK government is determined to walk away from the single market, it is all the more important to talk about what kind of transition from the status quo towards new permanent arrangements would be in the best interest of Scotland and of the UK. Theresa May appeared today to say that she was open to such transitional arrangements, and that again creates space for seeking to sustain positive relationships, at least in the short term. If there genuinely is an appetite for such transitional arrangements, Scottish ministers should seek to influence them and to maintain as many as possible of the positive benefits of our relationship with Europe. So in our view, the Scottish Government's option paper provides a basis for discussion, not the final answer to the problems we face. We recognise that different arrangements on freedom of movement and freedom of trade for different parts of the UK may be part of that answer, but we are absolutely clear that the integrity of the UK single market and customs union will remain critical to Scotland's interests. And we want to make the most of any transitional arrangements to minimise the economic dislocation which leaving the EU will bring. And to that end, Presiding Officer, I move the amendment in my name.
Thank you very much, Mr. McDonald. I now call on Willie Rennie to speak to move Amendment 3427.2. Mr. Rennie, 8 minutes or thereabouts, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I move the amendment in my name. This afternoon's speech from the Prime Minister, I think, confirms that the Conservatives are hell-bent on a hard Brexit, regardless of what the impact will be on millions of people through higher prices, greater instability, hitting jobs and hurting our economy. Withdrawing from the single market and the customs union is not in our country's interest, nor was it what people voted for on the 23rd of June. The Tories are turning Brexit into a democratic stitch-up, and it shows how vital it is that the public be given a say in a Brexit deal referendum. I listened to Dean Lockhart earlier on. That is the exact speech that Nigel Farage would have delivered just a few months ago. The Liberal Democrats, in contrast, stand for Scotland in the UK and the UK in Europe. Many in this chamber and outside want us to choose. To choose between the European Union and the United Kingdom. But we will not give up on either of those institutions, not just now. I will never choose. My ambition is for Scotland to be in both, and I will campaign for both. I'm an internationalist. I believe in cooperation with our neighbours. I am pro-European. I am pro-United Kingdom, and I will not give up on either. The argument that our interests are best served by working together equally applies to the UK as to the European Union. And listening to the speeches on this side, you could have reversed those speeches only a couple of years ago. The arguments that they were using for each were the arguments that could have been used in the independence campaign. That is how these two have turned the arguments, not just now, on their heads. The Conservatives have embraced a hard Brexit, and they tell us to give up on the EU. The SNP are desperate, desperate to tell us, as the end of Fiona Hislop's speech made clear, that we need to give up on the United Kingdom. And Labour, I don't know what Labour stand for anymore. I do not know whether they stand for the European Union. I do not know whether they stand for the United Kingdom either. They are prepared to accept a blank cheque for Theresa May to agree whatever she likes, and Lewis MacDonald's speech did not clear that up in any way whatsoever. Now, on a point of consensus, I do agree with the SNP's analysis of the Conservatives on Brexit. Hamstrung by their right, hell-bent on hard Brexit, no preparations. In fact, our analysis between our two parties is so similar that they're now adopting our slogans. The blank cheque Brexit was coined by the Liberal Democrats, but I am pleased to say that it has now been used in graphic form by the SNP. On the 24th of May last year, before the referendum, the now Chancellor, Philip Hammond, made a powerful case for the single market, one in which I agreed with. He ridiculed the suggestion that we could have it all, that access to the single market on the same terms as membership is possible. He ridiculed that. In fact, he said the Leave campaign was a manifesto for the impoverishment of the British people. The impoverishment of the British people. He was right then, and he is right now. And at that very moment, when it becomes clear how bad it's going to be and how impoverished we will become, Ruth Davidson switches sides to become a hard Brexiteer and make us all poorer. Theresa May sold out the single market at lunchtime today in her first major speech on the terms, not just now, before she had even opened the door to negotiate with the rest of the EU. What a betrayal of everything she, her Chancellor and Ruth Davidson promised. I'll take an intervention.
Adam Tompkins.
I just wonder whether Willie Rennie could possibly explain that this is a hard Brexit. We seek the greatest possible access, the greatest possible access to the single market through a new, comprehensive, bold and ambitious free trade agreement. The words of the Prime Minister today. That's not a hard Brexit. That's seeking full access to the single market. That's not hard Brexit.
Mr Rennie.
That was quite a nice try. But in reality, we all know that she is planning to take Britain out of the customs union and out of the single market. That is a hard Brexit. And Adam Tompkins needs to understand that before he stands up in this chamber again. Ruth Davidson's call. No, sit down, please. Ruth Davidson and her colleagues are prepared to impoverish the British people. Impoverish the British people because the Conservatives were incapable of resolving their internal civil war on Europe. Impoverish the British people because the Conservatives' tactical calculation that they could see off UKIP. Impoverish the British people because the Conservatives are only prepared to follow, not lead. They will not stand up for our economy, our security and our jobs. I will never hear it again from the Conservatives that they are the party of business and the economy. They have shredded that reputation with this decision today. Ruth Davidson now expects us to believe that Brexit is a great opportunity when she said only a few months ago it would be an unmitigated disaster. Some say this is the biggest mistake since Suez and the decision to go to war with Iraq. I think it is as monumental as those decisions. I think the long-lasting effect on our country and our economy, our jobs and our opportunities will be significant. But the Conservatives are prepared to roll over, no questions, no challenge, no leadership. Although we may agree with the SNP on the analysis, we differ on the solution. We do not need the chaos of independence to compound the chaos of Brexit. We don't address uncertainty by bringing more uncertainty. And the SNP's differentiated halfway house solution has not got off to a good start. We've heard from governments across Europe who have questioned whether this differentiated solution can work. I do not believe that it can work. The SNP's pre-Christmas paper is an apparent serious attempt to present a plan. But the SNP's plan, their idea of a plan, is to offer the solution that they always offer. The solution that they believe that the answer is to absolutely any problem you could possibly think of, and that is independence. It was thinly disguised in this paper, but Fiona Hislop revealed at the end that this is what it's all about. They'll dress it up in all sorts of different ways, but in reality, what they want is independence because they do not believe in anything else. I believe what we should go for is a Brexit deal referendum, so the British people can have a say on the final deal, on the detail. The first referendum on the detail. That, I believe, is the democratic way to proceed to project jobs and protect opportunities for people in this country. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We now move to the open debate. It's a tight 6 minutes for speakers. I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Alexander Stewart. Mr. McKee, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, the situation we find ourselves in at this time is not of our making. It's a consequence of internal schisms within the Tory party dating back decades. Scotland finds itself at risk of losing the substantial benefits of membership of the European internal market. This situation was not the preferred option of the last Prime Minister, and it was not the preferred option of this Prime Minister. It's not the preferred option of the great majority of Scots or of members of this Parliament, including the vast majority of those on the Tory benches who not that long ago were arguing passionately for Remain. But it's from this mess that we must work together to extricate ourselves, navigating our way through the fog of Brexit to find the option that delivers the best deal for Scotland within the UK, consistent with the wishes of the people of England and Wales to leave the EU and the clear desire of the people of Scotland to stay in the single market. With political vision and leadership, this circle can be squared, and through this proposal, the Scottish Government has done just that, proposing an option that works and one that we all have a responsibility to fully consider. The document makes clear the goal is to identify common ground with the UK government around a solution that would protect Scotland's place in the European single market from within the UK. The Scottish Government's proposal does not prioritise the European single market over free movement and free trade within the UK, just as the UK government believes that free trade and movement between the UK and the Republic of Ireland will continue after Brexit. This proposal seeks to secure the benefits of the European single market for Scotland in addition to, not instead of, free trade across the UK. So let's be clear about what the proposal is before us. Scotland will continue as a member of the European single market. Norway shows that it's not true that membership of the single market requires membership of the EU. Scotland would, however, be outside of the EU customs union if that is the option chosen for the UK by the UK government, and Scotland would continue as part of the UK to be part of the UK customs union. Membership of the single market, again, as shown by Norway, does not necessarily mean membership of the EU customs union. Liechtenstein and Switzerland are in a customs union with each other, even though the former is part of the EEA, while the latter is not. Scotland would, as a member of the single market, enjoy...
Mr. Lockhart.
Looking at the Norway option, would he agree with the head of the Norwegian delegation to EFTA, who made it clear that to enter the EEA agreement, a nation has to be either a member of the EU or EFTA, and to become a member of EFTA, Scotland would have to be independent?
Mr. McKee.
That's not the case. If you look at the situation currently with the Faroe Islands negotiating a position to become part of EFTA, That scenario is perfectly possible, and that the details of that are included in the document if the member cares to read through it. Scotland's a member would continue to enjoy free movement of labour, and there's no reason why Scots can't continue to enjoy the benefits of working and living across the EU, even as citizens in other parts of the UK deny themselves those rights. The Isle of Man is not a member of the EU. EU citizens are unable to work in the Isle of Man, and Manx citizens are already unable, under current situation, despite being British citizens, to enjoy free movement all across the EU. That demonstrating that differential solutions across these islands are possible, and there is no need for Scottish citizens to exclude themselves from the single labour market when the UK leaves the EU. There would be no hard border for people between Scotland and the rest of the UK. The UK government has been very clear that the common travel area will continue after Brexit. There will be no hard border between an island still in the EU and the UK outside of it. Differential immigration regimes within countries without internal borders are not uncommon. Provinces in Canada and states in Australia are concrete examples. The Prime Minister has made it clear that immigration controls will in any event be deployed at the point of employment, allowing for separate immigration solutions in different parts of the UK. Scotland can have different immigration policies from the rest of the UK. Indeed, whatever post-Brexit arrangements Scotland, like London, needs to explore a distinctive approach to our immigration needs. Nor would there need to be a hard border for goods between Scotland and the UK. The border between Sweden and Norway, two countries with very different relationships to the EU, or between Switzerland and Liechtenstein, two countries with a very different relationship to the European single market, but a customs union with each other, shows that that would work. This proposal would deliver benefits to Scotland, to the rest of the UK and to the EU. Remaining within the single market will give Scottish businesses advantages over those in other parts of the UK due to access in through the single market. The Scotland and Europe model also delivers significant benefits to the rest of the UK, allowing UK businesses to trade within the single market without leaving the UK. And it allows European businesses the benefit of trading within the UK from within the single market. A win-win-win for all concerned. For the UK government to fail to engage on these proposals is not only a slap in the face for the people of Scotland, it's also a dereliction of their duty to find the best solution for the UK as a whole. For Theresa May, this Scotland and Europe option provides a get-out-of-jail-free card, allows the UK to leave the EU while significantly mitigating the economic impact of Brexit and keeping the UK together. I urge members across this Parliament to take the time to read and consider the document, understand the proposals and to work with us to deliver this solution in the interests of Scotland. But I also say to the Prime Minister, a failure to engage with this proposal will not go unnoticed. It will go down in history as a moment when it was made crystal clear to the people of Scotland that this United Kingdom is anything but a partnership of equals.
Thank you very much. Alexander Stewart, followed by Ash Denham. Mr Stewart, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The referendum held on the 23rd of June of last year was decisive. The United Kingdom, as a member state of the European Union, took the decision to leave the political bloc. Deputy Presiding Officer, the fact that the trade within the UK domestic market is four times as important to Scotland compared to the trade within the EU single market, and I welcome the fact that the Scottish Government have recognised and have taken cognizance of that, but this also begs the question as to why they continue to put our participation within the UK single market in jeopardy. This position is utterly illogical. Thank you.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I thank Alexander Stewart for taking the intervention? Given the point he just made, would he say it seems somewhat illogical if the Conservative position, being as he's just described, is also to say they should jeopardise their biggest market, the UK's biggest market, which is the EU at 44% of exports, in favour of a deal with Donald Trump at around a third of that level? You can't have it both ways.
Mr Stewart.
Listen, we've made it quite clear we want full access to as many markets as we possibly can. And with this situation, we would get full access to markets. So I move on. The First Minister has made it quite clear that she has been forced into a situation of not ruling out a second referendum for Scottish independence only for this year. But the threat still looms large. Deputy Presiding Officer, it's having a negative impact on investment and business confidence in Scotland. The business community understand that. Why can't the Scottish Government understand the impact that they are creating with independence coming back again and again in the agenda? No, I'd like to make some progress, thank you. I'd like to make some progress. The recent survey carried out by the Federation of Small Businesses revealed that in the final quarter of 2016, small business confidence in the UK bounced back to the pre-Brexit referendum level. This is very much to be welcomed, and it shows the confidence that is there, and it shows that people believe in the future as we move forward. The small business index in the UK average is now 8.5%. But in Scotland, however, dear presiding officer, it sits significantly lower than that of any other part of the United Kingdom, and considerably lower than in London itself. It is this threat of another referendum on independence, not Brexit, that is having the most significant impact on confidence within business in Scotland. The Scottish Government have to acknowledge that they are creating this crisis in the business community. Nobody else.
No, I want to continue.
Please sit down,
the SNP should stop harming our economy by completely ruling out another referendum for the duration of this Parliament and end the uncertainty that they are creating. Rather than being obsessed with the single market membership, the Scottish Government should be doing all they can to work alongside the UK Government to ensure that we achieve the freest possible trade deal between the UK and the EU. No, thank you. Time is tight. I'm already halfway through the speech. But one that allows a United Kingdom to make its own trading relationship with other nations. The ability to forge our new trade deals with the rest of the world is vitally important in ensuring that this goes forward as a success. Deputy Presiding Officer, as the other parts of the world continue to outstrip the European single market in terms of economic growth, we need to negotiate new, bold trading relations with other countries beyond the European frontier. In Scotland's case specifically, while around 15% of our exports go to the rest of the EU, 20% of them go to the rest of the world. And regardless of your views on the US president-elect, his willingness to engage and to secure a quick and broad free trade deal with the United Kingdom is something that everybody in this chamber should welcome. Not only, but other countries like New Zealand and Australia have significantly indicated their desire to quickly negotiate a bilateral trade deal with Britain. And these countries, once again, Deputy Presiding Officer, see the opportunities that lie ahead and want to embrace these opportunities and do all they can to support us as we move forward as a nation in the world market. The Scottish Government's proposal set out in their Scottish Place in Europe publication seems to be more to do with politics than trying to ensure that Scotland has a meaningful input in the UK's Brexit negotiations. No, I'd like to make progress.
Member's not taking intervention.
Making suggestions
I can do that
such
by
as
myself,
continued single market membership for Scotland while the UK leaves is simply unhelpful. Such a ludicrous situation would necessitate a hard border at Berwick and stop Scottish businesses from having unfettered access to the UK's domestic market. That even, the SNP have to acknowledge, and as I said before, we are four times more important to Scotland than the EU within the single market. As I move on to concluding, Deputy Presiding Officer, perhaps the Scottish National Party stop using Brexit as a political smokescreen to mask their failings in government. They might be better able to represent Scotland's interests in the immediate negotiations in our future relationship with the European Union. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I support the amendment in Dean Lockhart's name. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I call Ash Denham to follow by Mark Griffin. Ms. Denham, please.
I realise that some members of the Tory benches wish to stop giving chamber time to the issue of Brexit, especially it was mentioned last week. But I assure them that on this, they are out of step with the public, who are desperate for more information on the subject. Scotland voted overwhelmingly to stay in the EU, and if the democratic will of the people of Scotland is to be realised, then Scotland's voice must be heard during the negotiations. The Scottish Government has now published its plan, Scotland's Place in Europe, outlining a potential way forward with a number of options. One option is to try to influence the UK government to take a soft Brexit. After today, I'll admit I don't hold out much hope of that option. Another option, of course, is that Scotland could become an independent country and a full member of the EU. But for today, I'd like to talk about the third option, which is that of a differentiated arrangement. I accept that the UK government has a democratic mandate to take England and Wales out of the EU. But the mandate in Scotland is very different. Scotland must not be taken out of the single market against its will. And all the indications are pointing towards what is called a hard Brexit. And for Adam Tompkins' information, being outside the single market and outside the customs union is regarded as a hard Brexit. Now, why is that such a problem for Scotland? Well, because of the effects it will have on our economy. Economists have said that a hard Brexit will cost up to 80,000 Scottish jobs and could cost the Scottish economy up to £11 billion per year, of course.
Mr. Lockhart.
I believe we're now on our 15th debate on Brexit. If the SNP would focus on domestic issues such as productivity, it could improve the Scottish economy by £45 billion, according to Scottish Enterprise. That is a multiple of the money we're talking about as a result of Brexit. That's why we're telling the government, get on with the day job.
Yeah. Ms. Denham.
I realise that the Scottish Tories' policy, and indeed the UK Tories' policy on Brexit, is to have your cake and eat it. But I think that after 7 months of no substantive improvements in setting out a plan by the UK government, we could all agree that cake is now stale. In challenging economic times, when global productivity growth is stalling, UK housing is so expensive, wages are stagnating, this is far from the time to inflict the economic carnage that would result from leaving the single market by choice. And it would be a choice. A choice we do not have to make. Scotland should negotiate to stay inside the single market. Being in the EEA would give us things like free movement of goods and services, allowing Scots to move around, to establish businesses, and to build careers in EU countries. It allows businesses to trade to a market of 500 million consumers, and 42% of Scotland's international exports go to the EU. It continues to make Scotland an attractive place for foreign direct investment and gives us access to a supply of skilled labour to fill gaps in our workforce, allowing companies to grow and flourish and universities to access the best talent for research. This option is feasible. It allows the UK government to respect their mandate whilst also respecting Scotland's quite different mandate, and it also protects Scotland's interests. The Prime Minister has said she would listen to the options, and that her view was of a United Kingdom where the four nations flourish side by side as equal partners. Now comes the hour when the Prime Minister can demonstrate that principle and show by acting in good faith that she is willing to listen and to act upon the voice of Scotland. The UK government appears to be open to the idea of a flexible Brexit where that applies to different sectors of the economy or to Northern Ireland and Gibraltar. It's important to recognise there are already a range of differentiated arrangements within the EU and the single market framework, reflecting a willingness throughout its history to be flexible. Examples of this include Denmark, which is a member, and Greenland and the Faroe Islands, which are not. The Faroe Islands are considering joining EFTA and have asked the Danish government to support it in doing so. Sure.
Daniel Johnson.
Saying, and I also appreciate the exploration of those options, but could the member actually give us an update on the status of those Faroese negotiations? My understanding is that they haven't been taken forward, and the Danish government actually rejected them as not being possible.
Ash Denham.
I think what I'm trying to do here is to lay out that there are a number of different variances within this framework, and so that all of these options are possible. The Channel Islands are not in the EU, but they are in the customs union. Liechtenstein and Switzerland are in a customs union with each other, though the former is in the EEA and the other is not. So a solution for Scotland would vary in detail, but the principle is already well established and would be the same. And I would join with Ivan McKee in calling on the UK government to support Scotland to negotiate a differentiated agreement where Scotland is in the single market, in the EEA and EFTA, in the same way that Norway, Liechtenstein and Iceland are, even if the rest of the UK is outside. And let's be clear, I do not underestimate the difficulties in this. There are significant practical and technical challenges with this option, but with the political will, I believe it is possible. We are in an unprecedented situation. There are no set rules for what happens now. Imagination will be required for whatever comes next. Differentiation within the UK is the very hallmark of devolution, allowing Scotland to make different choices because they're the right choices for our different circumstances and because they protect our interests. Fundamentally, devolution allows policy to be different across the UK precisely to reflect the democratically expressed preferences of the electorate. Scotland has democratically expressed a very different preference. A differentiated arrangement is technically possible. It doesn't cost the UK government anything. So I would ask the other parties in this chamber to give serious thought to this sensible and practical option and support the motion. Thank you.
I call on Mark Griffin to be followed by Graham Day. Time is really tight.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As Lewis MacDonald set out, we will be supporting the Scottish Government's motion today. We agree with the overall sentiments it expresses in each of the points it raises. We believe that Scotland benefits from having a strong relationship with the EU and that jobs and prosperity are best maintained with unrestricted access to the single market. We welcome that the Scottish Government has published a paper that lays out its options for maintaining Scotland's relationship with the EU, but we see that as a basis for discussions going forward and not as a final answer to the problems we face. We want the Scottish Government to engage with UK ministers on their paper of alternatives and, crucially, for UK government ministers to listen. But today marks a very significant stage in the Brexit process as Theresa May turns her back on UK membership of the single market. This makes serious engagement around Scotland's relationship with Europe all the more urgent. Last week, we debated the impact of Brexit on the human rights institutions of this Parliament in the UK, and given today's speech by the Prime Minister, it's something I want to revisit. During that debate, I made it clear that when key bills are lodged in Parliament this year, in particular the proposed Child Poverty Bill and Social Security Bill, we must revisit those themes so that we can best secure and enhance civil, political, economic, social and cultural rights for people in Scotland. The challenge I made to this Parliament to act is now starker than ever. Theresa May has detailed just what she actually means by Brexit means Brexit. She has, in one speech, reopened constitutional wounds, but at the same time has shown us that so much uncertainty lies ahead. I mentioned in the Chamber last week that Brexit will lead to our leaving the EU, so we will no longer be signed up to the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, and raised the question that until we decide otherwise, the European Convention on Human Rights will still be applicable through our membership of the Council of Europe and through the Human Rights Act 1998. That Labour Government Act brings home our rights, giving our most vulnerable citizens a powerful means of redress and protecting us, all of us, against the misuse of state power. And it's quite clear that the Tories, not content with putting Scotland's place in the EU at risk because of their reckless Brexit gamble, but also willing to put the future of the UK in danger at every turn, and now are pressing ahead with putting those human rights at risk too. But that antidote from the government benches of another referendum, yet more constitutional wrangling and uncertainty, won't protect Scots. The Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union includes a broad range of civil, political, economic, social and cultural rights. If the Charter no longer applies in the UK as a result of Brexit and no changes are made to compensate for that, there will be fewer human rights limits on the UK Parliament and this Parliament. And it's clear the challenge we now face in this Parliament that we need to protect and instil those rights into our own law. Because poverty erodes the values of dignity and equality that underpin all international human rights, we should act, not least because we have the power to make laws to protect communities, and it would be a disservice to Scots if we let the Tories remove those powers. Theresa May's speech today made promises on workers' rights, but given the Tories' record on employment rights, I won't be taking her word for it. Presiding Officer, we've got a job to do. The question we now need to think about is how we incorporate more of those rights into Scots law, using the powers that we do have, and prevent the Tories from removing rights from UK law. Scottish people don't need politicians from different halves of the country constantly facing off each other and furthering the Cold War of constitutional politics. But we do have to recognise in this debate, though, that we shouldn't lose sight of the fact that being part of the UK secures hundreds of thousands of jobs in Scotland, grows our economy and funds the public services that we all rely on every day. Our exports to the EU countries are worth about a quarter of the value of our trade with the rest of the UK. Scotland's trade with the UK single market is worth £48 billion. Scotland trades twice as much with the rest of the UK as we do with the EU and rest of the world combined. Presiding Officer, the last thing we should be considering following a hard Tory Brexit is withdrawn from our most important market and partnership. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Griffin. Graham Day, followed by Ross Greer.
Thank you. I wonder if we could, for a moment, focus on the human aspect of all of this. The people who are in the firing line of Brexit, or who could if Scotland finds itself with no access to the single market, potentially suffer directly from its consequences. I don't just mean the overwhelming majority of Scots who voted Remain, or indeed those who voted Leave, but not for the hard Brexit version that's emerging. I also mean the many EU nationals who have made Scotland their home and have found themselves being treated as bargaining chips or negotiating capital. The seasonal migrant workers who ensure Scottish agriculture functions, the 13% of staff at Aberdeen University, which I visited on Monday, who hail from other EU states. I don't know what the future is going to hold. The 450 students at Dundee and Angus College whose places are supported by European Union funding. And yes, the 80,000 Scots who it's predicted could lose their jobs within a decade if we are out of the single market. At the end of June of last year, a matter of days after the Brexit vote, Parliament debated the potential implications for Scotland. My contribution to that debate focused on the uncertainty for and impact on EU nationals living in our communities and the businesses who rely on EU migrant workers to succeed. Here we are, more than 6 months later, and I find myself returning to that theme, not to score political debating points, but because the intervening period has provided at best only partial apparent progress with the former and none with the latter. And these are real people and real Scottish businesses that we're talking about. Back last summer, in common with colleagues on these benches, I wrote to the 800 or so EU nationals living in my constituency to reassure them that they were welcome in Scotland and the Scottish Government would be doing all it could to protect their status. Now, I and colleagues were attacked for writing to these folk, but it's interesting to reflect all these months later on the allegation that we were stoking up fear amongst people who had no question marks over their status. Here's the thing, there were question marks over their status. Those question marks still remain, even though today the Prime Minister sought to shift the blame for that onto others by claiming she'd strike reciprocal residency deals as a priority, but one or two other member states are opposed to that. Presiding Officer, it will be interesting to see over the coming hours and days whether that's accepted as being the case by the other members of the EU or exposed as simply seeking cover for maintaining the bargaining chip approach. If it turns out that the UK remains behind the continuing uncertainty that these EU nationals face, then that would be unforgivable. Then we come to the migrant workers issue. In that debate of June, I highlighted the situation in my constituency with Angus Soft Fruits, who require 4,000 seasonal workers between March and November of each year. Best part of 7 months on, and with 2017 season almost upon us, again, we have no further forward in securing a positive outcome. Indeed, today's statement appeared perhaps to indicate a hardening on the issue. There had been positive noises from Amber Rudd and Andrea Leadsom around the principle of having some sort of seasonal permit scheme in place post-Brexit for the agricultural sector. But set against that, we'd also had the Chancellor, Philip Hammond, draw a distinction between highly skilled and highly paid EU workers and those who would be taking entry-level jobs. And discussions between their UK trade body and the UK government, Immigration Minister, went so swimmingly that Angus Soft Fruits told a committee of this Parliament that it was possible they would have to relocate their business and follow the workforce. And then today in her speech, the Prime Minister followed Philip Hammond in drawing that distinction between highly skilled migrants and anyone else, pledging she would deliver control over the number of people who come to Britain. No wonder the NFUS is this afternoon querying where this leaves them when it comes to accessing a necessary workforce. In contrast to that, the Scottish Government is very much alive to the dangers. I'm grateful to Mike Russell for taking the time to meet with myself and Angus Soft Fruits, commit to continue pressing the UK Government on this issue and to visiting the company's operation in Arbroath in the next few months. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government may not be in the driving seat when it comes to shaping Brexit, but it has offered sensible navigational advice, showing a willingness to compromise in order to minimise the impact of this appalling situation and a determination to protect the interests of the people it was elected by, along with Scotland's economic interests. But standing up for what's right for Scotland is a duty that falls to all of us, not just on the Scottish Government, but all 129 of us elected to serve in this Parliament. And that includes the Tories. Tory MSPs will have nowhere to hide at decision time tonight.
Either they can stand up to Westminster, Westminster Masters, and for Scotland's interest, which certainly aren't served by leaving the single market or the customs union, or roll over and join the Westminster government in pandering to the very worst Brexit elements within and out with its own ranks. It's over to them, Presiding Officer.
Ross Greer, to be followed by Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Earlier today, Theresa May gave a speech that was confused, contradictory and dangerous. It appears that the Westminster government is intent on hurtling towards a hard Brexit. Despite the odd, seemingly kind phrase, we've learned that there will be an end to free movement and we will be out of the single market. This is exactly the hard Brexit we had feared. And despite the single line acknowledging the Scottish government's proposals, the plans set out today are entirely incompatible with the Scotland's Place in Europe paper. Theresa May would have to depart far from today's speech to even get halfway towards the proposals from the Scottish Government, which we in the Greens had already seen as the limits of reasonable compromise. The Fraser of Allender Institute report, commissioned by this Parliament, often mentioned in recent debates, makes for pretty dark reading today. A hard Brexit will mean an £8 billion loss to our GDP, a £2,000 drop in the average wage, and the loss of 80,000 jobs here in Scotland. This is a Brexit plan dreamt up by ideologues of the Tory right. They don't need to worry about it, though. Those with existing wealth and power rarely do. The people this will hurt are the people that we all represent. Every one of us will know the consequence of a £2,000 drop in average wages in the areas that we represent. But the damage of a hard Brexit isn't just economic. As we've heard today, Brexit is about what kind of country, what kind of society we want to be. This Westminster government is indicating that it will fire the starting gun on a race to the bottom. How much lower can we go? Take EU employment rights. They are already only to a minimum standard, the idea being that nation states are free to legislate to a higher standard, and yet the UK is right at the bottom of the table. Last week, I laid out the hypocrisy of a Conservative Party which pledges to defend workers' rights, but whose major piece of anti-worker legislation in recent years was so sinister, the now Brexit minister described it as more akin to Franco's fascist regime than the UK of the 21st century. It is essential that we have the powers to defend workers' rights here in Scotland. So the Greens welcome proposals from the Scottish Government to devolve powers over employment, for example. If this were to happen in the event of Brexit, and we of course do not accept that Scotland will yet leave the European Union, we will have won these powers not just to maintain an unacceptable status quo, we will have won them to make bold, vital improvements to the rights of workers here in Scotland. This Westminster government has already been accused of creating a deliberately hostile environment for EU migrants as well. We've already witnessed this uncaring state in action. A Dutch woman, having lived in the UK for almost three decades, told to make preparations to leave her family. A German neuroscientist, having lived here for almost two decades, also told to make preparations to leave. And I'm sure we all have similar stories of errors in the system in our inboxes from constituents. If a differentiated Brexit is the result of this process, with Scotland staying in the single market, with control over immigration and asylum policies here, just as with workers' rights, we will have won not just the power, but the responsibility to end a cruel and broken system. The failures of this Tory government to guarantee the status of those EU citizens living here is nothing short of a disgrace. Even today, to the European press, Theresa May has failed to do this, attempting to pass the blame to other governments. This is a politics that Scotland must break free from. The Scottish Government has proposed a compromise where we retain membership of the single market. This would allow us to continue free movement and would, as mentioned, require devolution of, amongst other powers, that over employment law. It would offset some of the costs of Brexit and could give us some separation from the hard right neoliberal future that Westminster seems set to pursue. On trade, for example, it is essential that Scotland is not unwillingly subject to trade deals negotiated by the likes of Liam Fox. We're often told that this is one of the most powerful sub-state parliaments in the world. That was one of the promises made to us after the 2014 referendum. But while we stood powerless, Bologna brought an intercontinental trade deal grinding to a halt until the reservations of their elected parliament were addressed. If Scotland has a future inside the UK, these are the kind of powers that we require to adequately represent the needs of our society and our economy. However, the previously mentioned Fraser of Allender report estimates that a Norway-style EEA deal, albeit for all the UK, would in the best scenario see Scottish GDP drop by 3 million, see wages drop by an average of £800 per person, and would still lose over 30,000 jobs. This is quite a compromise. It's probably the Westminster government's last chance to ensure Scotland continues to be part of the UK. Yet for all Theresa May spoke about wanting the UK to be more united than ever before, she has steadfastly refused to compromise. I believe now that a vote on our own future is all but impossible to avoid. It's time we put Scotland's future in Scotland's hands, because it's certainly not safe with the Conservatives at Westminster.
I call Claire Adamson to be followed by Rachel Hamilton.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Could I open today with agreeing with the Prime Minister in her opening statements in her speech today? Because this means more than negotiating about our new relationship with the EU, it means taking the opportunity of this great moment of national change to step back and ask ourselves, what kind of country do we want to be? And who does Scotland want to be? In every local authority in Scotland, we voted to remain. And can I say to the Prime Minister, we did so with our eyes open too. And even now, I urge colleagues across the chamber to look to Scotland's place in Europe, look to the options presented for a differentiated solution for Scotland, and support the continuing work of the Scottish Government to secure Scotland's current position within the EU, secure Scotland's place in the European single market. Like many SPs across the chamber, and I would encourage Mr Stewart to go out and speak to a few more of his constituents and industries in his areas, I have been discussing what Brexit will mean for them. And without exception, the importance of one of the four freedoms of goods, services, capital and persons, those freedoms that define the core obligations of membership of the European single market, the one that they are most concerned about is the movement of labour. Whether that was a software or soft fruit industry, the free movement of labour is extremely important to Scotland's economy and its future. So I am appalled that the Tory party in Scotland seemed to... Yes, I will.
Adam Tompkins.
Imperative consensus with which she started her remarks. I agree that movement of labour is important to the Scottish economy. It's important to Scottish business. I agree that migrant labour, access to migrant labour, is important to the Scottish economy. But why does that access have to be free? It's not movement of migrant labour that we're talking about. It's uncontrolled immigration that we're talking about. So why does the movement that she and I agree is important to the Scottish economy have to be free?
Claire Adamson.
Draw Mr. Tompkins' attention to some of the comments that have come from the European... These are the four principles of the European Union. Claude Juncker had said, those who want to free access to our internal market have to implement our freedoms without exception or nuance. Or Angela Merkel, who has said, access to the single market is only possible under the condition of adherence to the four basic principles, movements of goods, capital, people and services. This is not an a la carte menu that we can pick and choose from. It's membership of the club and abiding by the club's rules. Presiding Officer, I'm appalled that the Scottish Tories seem to have abandoned their position even after the Brexit vote. At that time, Ruth Davidson said that the overriding priority was to stay in the single market. Indeed, on national television, BBC Sunday Politics in July, she said, I want to stay in the single market, even if the consequence of that is maintaining free movement of labour. So what has changed? What's that material change in circumstances that now lead the Tory front benches to be arguing for the Tory hard Brexit, which no one, I believe, thought would happen, and it would be to this extent when they voted to leave the EU. In the debate, we've had the great revelation, not of what Brexit means Brexit, we now know it means hard Brexit. Now, the big revelation in this debate seems to have been the SNP believe independence is the best solution for Scotland. Who would have thought? And I can understand why the Liberals and the Tories seem absolutely fascinated with this position. It is, after all, a consistent position, something they seem very unfamiliar with. But it's a legitimate stance for us to take in the SNP, just as it is legitimate that where we are now is to argue for the support for our government to continue to maintain Scotland's position in Europe, in the single market, within the relationship that we currently have within the UK. And I would really urge the Tories to get behind this commitment. Yes, Will.
Willie Rennie.
Does she disagree with the First Minister when she said earlier on this year during that debate after the referendum that this process was emphatically not about independence? It's clear that it always has been about independence.
Claire Adamson.
Mr Rennie, I don't think it will come to a surprise to anyone in the Scottish nation to know that the SNP believe that the best solution for Scotland is an independent Scotland. That does not mean that we don't argue for what's best for Scotland each and every day that we represent the people of Scotland in this place. Now, one of the other things that's been mentioned over and over again is this will be an extremely difficult solution for Scotland to achieve. Not impossible, extremely difficult. Well, Presiding Officer, it's not called hard Brexit for nothing. But let's get behind this government. Let's get behind the proposals in Scotland's future. Let's get to the bottom of securing Scotland's position in the single market and our relationship with the EU, because that's the type of country we want to be.
Rachel Hamilton, to be followed by Richard Lougheed.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today, our amendment to the motion encourages all parties and the Scottish Government to work with the UK Government and other devolved governments in the UK to achieve the best possible negotiated outcome for Scotland and the United Kingdom. Negotiating the terms of Brexit with the EU27 will be a highly complex task. Reaching consensus will not be easy. The Joint Ministerial Committee, in its new framework, will feature representatives of the devolved administrations, and they will be fully engaged in the negotiation process. Today, our Prime Minister set out a clear message that she wants the UK Government to work together to find common ground and pursue a bold and ambitious free trade agreement with the EU in order to achieve the freest possible trade in goods and services. That is why current monthly intergovernmental government discussions in the form of the Joint Ministerial Committee are key to Scotland's place in negotiations and provide an important platform for all devolved administrations. The European and External Relations Committee recently produced a report compiling 150 pieces of written submissions in response to call for evidence. The report drew together the views of individuals, bodies and organisations across Scotland, which highlighted the needs of different sectors such as agriculture, for example. So how will current EU funding programmes be replaced by... Yes, I will take an intervention.
Joan McAlpin.
Yes, I'm glad she raised the work of the committee, because we have engaged widely with them right across Scottish society. But I would point out that the report hasn't actually been published yet.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank Joan McAlpine for that intervention, and I will not be revealing any of the report. So, in the context of the information that has been published, for example, how will current EU funding programmes be replaced by domestic funding arrangements? These are the type of arrangements that will need to be discussed going forward. We welcome the Chancellor of the Exchequer's announcement that a commitment to the continuation of CAP funding up until 2020 will be forthcoming, and it should be the intention of Mike Russell, although I'm sorry to hear he's not here today, to continue to support negotiations for industries such as the Scottish agricultural sector, who rely on support payments accounting for 2/3 of total net farm income in Scotland. It is crucial that the Scottish Government publicly recognise the importance of the UK domestic market to Scotland's economy over the EU's single market too. Yesterday, the Scottish National Farmers Union sent a briefing paper, and I quote, "Scotland's most important trade partner is the rest of the UK. Some 80% of our produce goes to the UK, and this cannot be undermined." Likewise, Fraser Allender Institute stated that it's estimated that whilst 250,000 Scottish jobs are tied to the EU, 1 million more rely on Scotland being part of the EU. And we must look at the positives. Scotland forms part of the United Kingdom, which is one of the fastest growing economies in the G7, affording us strong negotiating stance with potential new global partners such as New Zealand and America. We currently operate within some of the most stringent rules and regulations when producing goods and services, which will give us the confidence to export quality products. Moreover, the Bank of England will upgrade its UK growth forecast next month, and this is generally all positive. It's clear that we must prioritise relationships with our largest trading partner, and I make a plea for those wishing to break up our country. Please take the threat of an independence referendum off the table once and for all. The Scottish Parliament will need to use their new economic and fiscal powers and responsibilities wisely. Depending on how the new devolved powers are used will determine how Scotland can best position itself post-Brexit. Ministers say that vital tax powers will create a fairer and prosperous Scotland. What we want to see is support for businesses, giving us a high degree of competitiveness, attracting inward investment and encouraging entrepreneurship. The SNP motion states that the UK as a whole should retain its place in the single market, ensuring rights not just for business but for citizens, and that in the event that the UK opts to leave the single market, alternative approaches within the UK should be sought that would enable Scotland to retain its place within the single market. It is regretful for the 2 million of us who opposed an independence referendum back in 2014 that the First Minister decided to publish a draft consultation on a second independence bill. Surveys have shown that at least a third of SNP voters also voted to leave the EU, allegedly alongside a number of SNP MSPs in this chamber today. And it may pain members across the chamber to hear, but the EU referendum was not designed to put Scottish people in a position of choosing between membership of the UK and the EU. I haven't got much time, but okay, I will.
Alistair Allen.
Can the member clarify where in the Scottish Government's proposals it is proposed that people of Scotland should have to choose between trading with the UK or the EU?
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the member for that intervention, and it is just obvious that if you put voters in that situation, that your Leave voters in particular, where they have already voted to say yes to an independence referendum but said no to an EU referendum. Finally, Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government's Scotland's Place in Europe paper explores ways in which Scotland could retain its place in the single market. The Norwegian model is an example. Let me explain. Norway is a member of the single market but not a member of the EU. Professor Ulf Sudrup, the director of the Norwegian Institute of International Affairs, stated in his lessons from the Norway-EU relationship, the truly unique element of the Norwegian EU arrangement entails integration without representation. And that is not something that the First Minister wants in her Scotland's Place in Europe paper. I will come to a close.
No, I think you have come to a close. Thank you, Ms. Hamilton. Richard Lochhead, followed by Oliver Mundell.
As one of the members said earlier on, I think it's very important to bear at the front of our minds that the whole Brexit debate is now impacting on people's everyday lives in Scotland. And as we can see from the economic statistics in today's news, this is certainly the case. And if you look at the Guardian online copy, for instance, the headline is UK inflation hits 2-year high. It goes on to talk about Brexit-fueled falling pound will squeeze family finances in 2017. And it says the worries stem from the sterling's drop against other currencies since the vote to leave the EU last summer. A weaker pound has raised the cost of imports, such as food and fuel, and businesses are starting to pass that on to customers. It goes down to say the pound is down almost 20% against the dollar since the referendum. Then it says, on Tuesday, the technology company Apple said it was raising prices on its UK Apple store by almost 25% to reflect the sharp depreciation of the pound, which no doubt will affect hundreds of thousands of people in Scotland as well. So whether it's food prices, input costs for our factories and our businesses, or even Apple products, this is an issue that's having a real-life impact on people that we represent in this Parliament. And I do genuinely believe that the people of Scotland did not vote for a hard Brexit, which the UK Tory Prime Minister has outlined today. Dean Lockhart even said in his opening remarks that it's really important the SNP listen to the people of Scotland. Well, Scotland voted to remain in the EU. 62% of people voted to remain within the EU. And if Dean Lockhart and the other Conservatives want to listen to their constituents, they'll also find that many of the 38% who voted to leave actually did not vote to leave the single market or take all the economic damage that's now perhaps or probably in the pipeline due to the UK government's policy. So I put it to the Conservatives, it's the SNP that are listening to people of Scotland, and it's the Conservatives that are not listening to people of Scotland. Absolutely.
Dean Lockhart.
I would just remind him that a higher majority of people voted to remain in Scotland in the independence referendum. Will you listen to those people and rule out an independence referendum for our generation?
Absolutely.
Richard Lockhead.
The SNP absolutely respect the results of the 2014 independence referendum. Isn't it such a pity that the Conservative Party will not respect the results of the referendum in Europe and Scotland as well, where 62% of people voted to remain? And we'll come on to the options facing Scotland for the future. But in terms of respecting referendum results, it really is important the Conservative Party, who keep referring to themselves as the official opposition in this Parliament, do actually listen to the people of Scotland. I was aghast, absolutely aghast, to see in the Prime Minister's speech sympathy expressed for Spanish fishermen in terms of the impact of Brexit, and of course not a mention for the concerns expressed by Scotland's fishing industry or seafood sector about the potential of leaving the single market or severing all links with Europe, even in a Brexit situation. That's also a very serious situation. Can I give the Conservatives a short history lesson here, perhaps, in the most respectful way I can? In the 1980s, the Spanish managed to negotiate early access to Scottish waters in terms of our fishing grounds. The response of the north of Scotland, the Highlands and Islands, the northeast of Scotland, was to eject every single Conservative elected politician in Parliament from that part of the country. You are now in danger of repeating history, because believe you me, if you sail down the fishermen down the river once again in terms of the Brexit negotiations, the people of the north of Scotland will vote out every single Conservative MSP and MP at the next election as well. And George Eustace, of course, was in the news just a few months ago saying that it was potentially the case that the UK would use the fishing industry as a bargaining chip during the Brexit negotiations. And then here we have today, Theresa May, the UK Prime Minister, saying that she's got some sympathy for the plight of the Spanish fishermen. So that will go down like a bucket of rotten fish in Scotland's coastal communities today when they hear about that comment. Absolutely.
Jackson Carlow.
I feel I just need to correct the member's history. In fact, in the 1992 election, the Conservatives gained a seat in the North East. And in 1983, in fact, we retained all but two of the seats we'd won in Scotland. And it's worth remembering that throughout the whole of the 1980s, in every one of those elections, the Conservatives won more seats than did the SNP.
Richard Lockhead.
I remember the Conservative wipeout in 1987, which I'm old enough to remember as well. And a big part of that wipeout in Scotland was the way in which the UK government, time and time again, betrayed Scotland's fishing communities. Can I, however, also point to other comments in Theresa May's speech today as well. She says that there are two ways of dealing with different interests. You can respond by trying to hold things together by force, tightening a vice-like grip that ends up crushing into tiny pieces the very things you want to protect. And then she says, or you can respect differences and cherish it even. And I would argue to the Scottish Conservative Party, if that applies within the European context, surely it applies within the UK context as well. So why can't we have a Conservative Party that respects the differences within the UK and perhaps even cherishes it in terms of their approach to the Brexit in the future? And I think that she also goes on to talk about the need for a compromise and for using our imagination on both sides of the debate in terms of Brexit. Again, can we not have that approach from the UK Prime Minister and the Scottish Conservatives in the context of Scotland's position, given that 62% of Scots did vote to remain within Europe, and many of the others, as I said before, want to remain or retain our economic links as well. And I think that's something hopefully the Scottish Conservatives can reflect upon after this debate. I also want to turn to Ruth Davison's comments, because, of course, back in July, she was saying that her view was that Scotland should retain membership of the single market, even if the cost of that was to remain free movement, retaining free movement of labour.
You must close, Mr. Lockhead.
We need to hear if that's the Scottish Conservative Party's position still today, because one thing that's so important from the perspective of everyone that's going to be affected by this debate in Scotland is that all the political parties stand together, stand up for Scotland's interests, and put these interests first in terms of the way forward for securing the living standards in this country.
Oliver Mundell, to be followed by John McAlpine, and it's really tight. Can I remind people, if you go over time, it just penalises your colleagues.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Following this morning's powerful speech from the Prime Minister, I'm delighted to have the opportunity to contribute to this afternoon's debate, because perhaps for the first time we have something concrete and sensible to discuss. Indeed, we have much of the clarity the SNP have been demanding. And I think it is therefore a bit disappointing that they've decided to confuse agreeing with the proposals that have been set out today, with the fact that the commitment to set them out has been delivered. I would have thought even they would have welcomed confirmation that the freest possible trade agreement with the EU, the protection of workers' rights, and cross-border cooperation on tackling crime will be key priorities for the UK government, recognising some of the suggestions they themselves have put forward in their paper. However, credit where credit's due, I think today's motion does make it clear that the Scottish Government is slowly edging towards a more realistic outlook, and I think it's to be welcomed that ministers are now so explicitly recognising that this was a UK-wide decision to leave the European Union, and it is the UK as the member state who will therefore be taking forward negotiations.
Richard Lockhead.
Mr. Mandel, for giving way. His Scottish leader said in July that I want to stay in the single market, even if a consequence of that is maintaining free movement of labour. Is that the member's position today?
Oliver Mandel.
I think that Ruth Davidson's made her position very clear in fighting Scotland's corner within this debate, and by securing the freest possible trade agreement with the rest of the EU, she will be helping secure jobs for people here in Scotland. And I think it's about time that the SNP got behind that approach rather than harking from the sidelines. And I think it is welcome, and Mr. Lockhead can shake his head, but I think it is welcome that government ministers have in this motion today recognised that Scotland's trade within the UK and our access to the UK single market is worth four times that of our trade with Europe, a point that my colleagues have been making time and time again. However, that said, in my view, the motion still strikes the wrong balance and the wrong tone. Since the day after the referendum, when Nicola Sturgeon hurried out her statement in response to the referendum result, the SNP have failed to properly address the real concerns and views of the Scottish people. There is a big difference between independence, which the SNP want, and standing up for Scotland's interests. The reality is that most people across our country, just like across the rest of the United Kingdom, recognise that regardless of how they voted, that they want the UK government to deliver an outcome for the whole of the UK in order to leave the EU as the vote confirmed the wish of the British people to be. They don't want to be left in limbo on whether or not we're having a further independence referendum, and they don't want to be left in limbo when it comes to continued membership or partial membership of the EU. The Scottish Government's own paper, Scotland's Place in Europe, takes a great deal of time to cover a number of options that would leave Scotland in a different position from our counterparts across the rest of the UK. And I would say there's absolutely no evidence to suggest that that's the will of the Scottish people. And again, it's high time for the SNP to differentiate between its own desires for a less unified United Kingdom and the wishes of the Scottish people. Indeed, in contrast to the UK government's clear and reasonable plan, the paper on Scotland's place on Europe is both highly complex when it comes to delivering identifiable outcomes, and more disappointingly, is completely underwhelming when it comes to delivering an outcome that people here in Scotland desire. It's clear to me, and though it seems to have escaped many of the hard left separatists on the SNP benches, that people living in Scotland want to see an orderly and expedient Brexit. And whilst they do want a bespoke model, I don't think that anyone living across Scotland is inspired by the concept of being some kind of reverse Greenland or the new Norway. And I know that the Scottish National Party... Yeah?
Ivan McKee.
Thank you. I just want to get the member's reaction to... I heard Suzanne Evans of UKIP on the Daily Politics show this afternoon commenting on the Prime Minister's speech, and she said she was delighted, and I said, I quote, because Theresa May was channelling UKIP. That's what Suzanne Evans said. Can I ask for the member's reaction to that, given that he was a supporter of Remain and his party is now part of a party that's moved so far to the right in this issue that it's channelling UKIP?
Oliver Mundell. Yeah.
I don't think I'll be taking any lectures on being a populist party that models UKIP from the SNP, who themselves seem absolutely... Well, you can shake your head, but if you want to stand up and intervene, then go ahead. Because it's the Scottish National Party that have a fixation on a single issue. It's the Scottish National Party who are determined to bring back the debates of the past. It's the Scottish National Party that fail to recognise that the United Kingdom is one of Europe's largest economies and that we're not on a par with the Faroe Islands, that the United Kingdom is more than capable of negotiating a good free trade deal with Europe, and that we will be able to compete globally rather than trying to scaremonger and perpetuate a negative outlook. And that's why, rather than...
The member has
last
no time.
10 seconds, which is why, rather than the Scottish focusing on the Scottish National Party's usual doom and gloom, I think it's time that we start focusing on the opportunities that truly global free trade offers Scotland and our economy. Thank you.
Joan McAlpin, followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too listened carefully to the Prime Minister's speech today. She talked about the sort of country we want to live in, but the vision she outlined was not the kind of country I want to live in or that 62% of Scots voted for. Theresa May's threat, trailed by Philip Hammond, was a deregulation that cut price Britain, as the Cabinet Secretary said, a race to the bottom. It suggested that the UK government is leading a country which is desperate to survive its self-inflicted woes by undercutting its neighbours. That is why it's so important that the Scottish Government paper argues we must get powers over employment and social protection to stop Scotland being dragged down there with the UK government. The Prime Minister at least made it clear today that the UK would be outside the single market, something even our own Tory leader in Scotland has argued against. And it's something nearly every single business organisation has argued against too. Today, Mrs May said something I do agree on, however. More trade means more jobs, she says. Well, leaving the single market means barriers to trade. It means less trade and less jobs. The Prime Minister's delivery today was smooth, but that served to gloss over an inherent incoherence at the heart of her speech. You cannot, as Mrs May suggests, leave the customs union but negotiate away customs controls. Controls that the ports operators have warned will cause serious tailbacks and increased costs. And you cannot negotiate a free trade deal, as Mrs May claimed today, while giving special treatment to car manufacturers or financial services. As trade experts have told my Europe committee, the World Trade Organization rules specifically state that opt-outs for individual sectors are not allowed. Deals must cover all sectors of the economy, and it's not even clear that a free trade deal, however bold and ambitious it's constantly referred to as being, can be negotiated within the two-year window. If Mrs May was as confident of securing that free trade deal that Oliver Mundell talked about, why did she feel the need to threaten our European partners by undercutting them in a race to the bottom? We know, for example, that the CETA agreement with Canada took 7 years to negotiate, and that's 7 years to negotiate something that is suboptimal to the access that we currently have to the single market, which brings me to the motion in the Scottish Government's paper. I was pleased to hear the Prime Minister say that she would consider the Scottish Government's paper very carefully. As Cabinet Secretary suggested, Mrs May's speech spelled out that Brexit will be complicated, messy and, for all her rhetoric, uncertainty. The Scottish Government's proposal is clear, but it does not pretend to be an easy option. It does, however, attempt to deliver the democratic desire of the people of Scotland to remain in the single market. In fact, people in Scotland voted to remain in the EU, so as such, the SNP paper position is a significant
compromise.
Will the
member take an intervention?
Yes, I will take an
intervention. Oliver Mundell.
Does the member accept that there's a significant difference between people voting to remain part of the European Union as was and voting for a suboptimal halfway house that delivers none of the advantages of leaving the European Union and doesn't deliver the same level of benefits as being a full member?
Joan McAlpin.
Well, people in Scotland voted to remain in the EU and voted to remain in the single market, and most of the people on the benches that Oliver Mundell occupies, but not Oliver Mundell, most of those people argued for Scotland to remain in the single market, and that's what this paper proposes. And it's not going to be easy, but Brexit's not going to be easy. To return to the paper, I think the fact that the compromise in the customs union that Scotland offers is incredibly significant. We've said that we'll shadow the UK's decision on the customs union, even though all the evidence suggests that it's far better to remain in the customs union. Scotland's place in Europe, as well as being a compromise, and I think this is a really important point, is part of a process, and that process is the journey that is Scottish devolution. It makes reasonable proposals about the further devolution of powers over areas such as immigration, which during the referendum campaign, Michael Gove wrote to the First Minister and suggested could be devolved to Scotland. It suggests further devolution of powers over employment and social protection, which I've already referred to, and also, crucially, the power for Scotland to enter into discussions and agreements with other countries, which would allow us to work with EFTA as a way of remaining within the EU, of course, with the cooperation of the UK government. And that is that's the very key issue here. A few years ago, we were told it wasn't possible for Scotland to have additional powers, for example, over income tax. And as part of the devolution process, people have changed their minds and Scotland has assumed those additional powers. So it's absolutely not out of the question for additional powers over treaty making, for example, to be devolved to Scotland, as this paper suggests. And indeed, the EU already negotiates with federal countries which have provinces which do have treaty-making powers, such as the Canadian provinces, who were very closely involved in the negotiations over CETA. I also noted from the paper that the Scottish Government is clear that if that is not enough, then the UK Government could cooperate with Scotland and sponsor Scotland's membership of EFTA. And if Theresa May really does value what she calls the precious union of the UK, she would respect Scotland's position, Scotland's vote, and she would pay close attention to this paper and how the UK can work with Scotland and the rest of Europe to deliver a democratic result for all the countries of the United Kingdom. Thank you.
We have two speakers left. I'm afraid I'm going to have to cut you both to 5.5 minutes. Pauline McNeill, followed by Tom Arthur.
So today's speech by Prime Minister Theresa May is the most significant yet since the referendum on the 23rd of June. We had some clarity, some commitments, and still some unanswered questions, but at least I do welcome the limited clarity that we got from the speech today, setting out 12 objectives for the focus of the government in its attempts to negotiate the deal for Britain and Scotland, gives us some guidance in the months ahead, and we now know that both parliaments will vote on the Brexit deal. We know that we are here because of the unbelievable and remarkable divisions within one particular party. We know that Theresa May said clearly that a vote to leave the citizens would be worse off. And we remember that she also said that a vote to leave the European Union was not a vote to leave the single market. And she's U-turned on that one today. In a sense, that is very frustrating, but actually, I just think it's kind of pointless now, given the enormity on the complexity of the road ahead. The most critical time I remember in my lifetime. I want to make at least some positive contribution to the debate. Whether it's extreme Brexit, hard Brexit, or whatever Brexit you want to call it, that marks a serious and separation from most of Europe's mechanics and institutions. I speak as someone who seriously considered options on both sides of the referendum to leave or to remain. And I considered leave because I always had concerns about the remoteness of Europe to ordinary people. I was appalled at the behaviour of the European Union to Greece, a nation which has had imposed upon it crippling debts and arrangements. But like Yanis Varoufakis, the former Greek finance minister, I felt it was better to remain and reform within. So I do see opportunities that exist, and I want to qualify that. Thanks to Adam Tompkins, did actually take up his recommendation, and I'm reading through Tim Shipman's very interesting and staggeringly interesting book on the behind the scenes on Brexit. And what some of the commentators say believe that if David Cameron had asked the EU for some restrictions of freedom of movement, he may have actually won that. And I just think it's an important lesson in history. We'll never know the answer to that. So I do believe that there are some opportunities that exist.
But I do believe that those opportunities have to be based on as best a relationship that we can have with the single European market and access to that important market. But Theresa May said today that she wants Britain to be a magnet for talent. But if she believes that, then the Tories will have to embrace a much more progressive policy on immigration, hard though that is. If foreigners feel that coming here is not a welcoming country, we are not going to attract the best talent. We cannot be this international Britain, a global power, attracting the best talent without implementing a more progressive immigration policy, albeit there may well be some controls on that. So I think there's a lot of convincing to do. She also said, as Richard Lockhead pointed out, that she mentioned diversity many times in her speech, that it shouldn't be done by force, but she has to lead on this if she doesn't want it to be done by force. I call on upon her to do that if we want to look like a nation which is immigration friendly. And on that point, fully engaging Scotland and the other nations in how we move forward, I believe, and I have said in this chamber, that it does mean that we have to have a much bigger say in an immigration policy post-Brexit. If Scotland has shortages of skills in any sector, we must be free. There must be some mechanism that we can influence immigration to the UK, which benefits Scotland. If anything is affecting confidence in British markets, it's absolutely certain that above everything else, it clearly is Brexit, as we were interesting to see the results or the response to the markets today. The customs union question is still a matter that we still to hear more detail on. But if I've heard Theresa May correctly, it's sounding to me as though there might be some special terms for certain sectors or certain industries. And although I appreciate that, I laid a motion last week on the fear of the finance industry, which the head of HBC said was almost like a Jenga tower waiting to fall apart. It is important, and definitely Brexit will slow down what we've been used to in the finance sector up until now being part of a wider European Union. But I do think that all sectors must have access to the customs union, and I don't really believe special deals for sectors is really at all acceptable. Just in closing, presiding officer, I probably will vote for the government motion tonight, but I just want to make clear on what terms I will be voting for the government motion. I believe membership of the single market is desirable. I think access to the single market is essential, but I want to see the discussion through to the end, and I believe it at the very early stages of that. I want the Scottish Government to continue the discussions, and I do think that some of the plan I can support. I want them to continue to do that. It is not by implication, if we fail to do that, support for a second referendum, and I just wanted to make that clear before I vote tonight. We have a very long way to go in this debate, and we must work our way through it, paying attention to every dot and every detail. Thank you very much.
The last of the closing speeches is Tom Arthur.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I have to say, as much as I expected the contents of the Prime Minister's speech today, it was still a bit of a punch in the gut. I did hold out hope that perhaps she would listen to the entreaties of the Scottish Government and others and see common sense and say, no, we would seek to preserve the UK's place in the single market. But it is not to be. But I was hoping perhaps in this debate as well we might see a different approach from the Conservative benches, one which recognises their responsibility to the people of Scotland and not simply to the interests of the City of London or other interests out with this country. And I have to say, it's very disappointing because I know there's many reasonable members in the Conservative benches who campaigned to remain, who still believe it we should be part of the European Union and know in their hearts that's the right thing to do, but they're not willing to say it. Rather, what we have is we have a sellout. It was only in June that the leader of the Conservative Party in Scotland stood in this very chamber and said that retaining our place in the single market was a priority. That was after the referendum. That was a clear statement of principle, and they have reneged upon it. Now, it wasn't just that. The UK Tory manifesto in 2015 spoke of membership of the single market, and numerous Conservative front benchers here and in the UK government spoke of the catastrophic effects of withdrawal from the European Union and withdrawal from the single market. Yet now, when they have an opportunity to speak up for their constituents? Do they take that opportunity? No. And I think it's worth remembering how this Parliament came about. This Parliament, for many people, was inspired by the experience of living through 18 years of remote Conservative government from London. A situation when we were helpless, with no opportunity to speak for ourselves. That was something bitterly experienced by my own constituents in Linwood. So everyone in this Parliament has a fundamental duty to speak up for Scotland's interests. That was the vision of this Parliament. Many people campaigned, many people in the Labour Party campaigned for this Parliament, so never again would the Scottish nation be subject to a Tory government that was not elected here, taking decisions that would be economically and socially catastrophic. So when this Parliament does speak up on Brexit, when it does advocate a positive solution for Scotland, when the Scottish Government puts proposals forward, it is perfectly, not just entitled to do so, it is duty-bound to do so. And so it really is disheartening when members of the Conservative Party come in here and complain that we are debating Brexit. Now, I would like to touch upon a few of the Conservative responses and contributions in the debate today. I think that we are at a really crucial moment in our history. This is a time for inspired leadership. It is a time for vision. You know, I was reflecting as we approach Inauguration Day in the US presidential election, President-elect Trump on Friday, of what is leadership. And I recall the words of JFK. He spoke at Rice University in 1962 when he was setting the target of reaching the moon. And he said, "We choose to go to the moon and other things, not because they are easy, but because they are hard, because they will serve to organise and measure the best of our energies and skills, because that challenge is one that we are willing to accept and we are unwilling to postpone, and we intend to win." And then I listen to the Conservative benches today, gurning, whining, "We can't do it. It's too difficult, it's too hard, I'm very sorry, I'm pressed for time, I would otherwise take an intervention." That is not what we need. That was an effete, insipid, uninspired and supine performance. A complete betrayal. Constituents of many Conservative members voted overwhelmingly for Remain, and they are now being betrayed. But I thought there was something Well, I have a conception of democracy, which is the Scottish democracy, and the people of Scotland voted overwhelmingly to remain within the European Union. And I will take, and I'll, it's time, I cannot, I don't know much more time, but I will say one thing. Mr. Mundell accused me of being, and my colleagues, of being left-wing separatists. To the first charge, I'll plead guilty, but the only separatists in this chamber are the separatists sitting around Mr. Mundell. His party, the party that wants to make firms say how many European workers they have, it wants to put a levy on European workers for companies, it will not give security and guarantee the status of European citizens. These are the real separatists. Good presiding officer.
We now move to the closing speeches, and I call Willie Rennie. Up to 7 minutes, please, Mr. Rennie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. There were two contributions in particular that I was quite attracted to. One was from Graham Day, who talked about the fruit workers in his constituency and the insecurity that they feel. I too have many agricultural workers in my constituency in North East Fife. Many of them feel equally insecure by the inability of the Conservative government to guarantee their future in this country. The second contribution was from Richard Lockhead, who talked about the real direct impact, the economic impact on people's lives, the value of the pound, inflation, jobs, security. And that's at the heart of what this is all about. This is about people's lives. And although on the 23rd of June last year, we did vote to leave the European Union, what that vote ignores is the impact that it has on people's lives. The fact that our lives, our communities, are intertwined now with members, individual citizens from other members of the European Union. that their lives are intertwined with ours. And those lives will not be easily undone. Those connections will not be easily broken. So although the Conservatives can stand here today and lecture everybody else about being concerned about the future economic conditions in this country, I think they fail to recognise the direct impact on individual people's lives, and that it will not be as easy as they paint. It will be much more difficult. And we heard speeches from the Conservatives, one after the other, today, making the direct opposite speeches from what they made just a few months ago. And actually, there was I made a comment earlier on about adopting the language of Nigel Farage. Nigel Farage has actually tweeted today commending Theresa May for adopting the language that he's been using over the last 10 years, but was ridiculed for doing so. The Conservatives have adopted this isolationist approach, lock, stock and barrel. And that is disappointing for a party that claims to be in favour of the economy and jobs for our country. I have to say, I also was amused by Oliver Mundell condemning the SNP for fixating on a single issue. I think the issue that the Conservatives have been fixating for a single issue is the European Union over the last 10 years, and look at where it's got us to. It's posing great risks to our economy. But today's debate, there was much promise for today's debate. The build-up was quite tantalising. Over the weekend, we had the two Anguses, Angus McNeill and Angus Robertson, banging their fists on the table through Twitter on this occasion. Angus Robertson, who is the deputy leader, no less, said, "Scotland didn't vote Tory or for a hard Tory Brexit. Single European market now being blocked by the Tories. Scotland will not accept this." And I can imagine him banging his fist on the table while doing so. Then Angus McNeill intervenes with hashtag material change mandate, probably not exactly going viral. He said, "We need a second independence referendum." Great promise that this was going to be the day that when they had been tipped over the edge and now we were going to get this second independence referendum. But alas, all we do get is promises that we're going to get this, but they never bite the bullet. What we need is a real focus on the big monumental decision that has been imposed on our country. Pauline McNeill was right. This is probably the biggest decision in our lifetime, in her lifetime, in my lifetime. But this is not the time for micromanagement. This is the time for big, bold solutions. And that's why we have said that there should be a Brexit deal referendum. Because if the Conservatives are so confident about the deal that they can negotiate, they are so confident it will be such a brilliant deal for Britain, then why not put it before the British people so they can have the final sign-off? Why not? Why not? No, not just now. Why are they keeping it within the Conservative Party rather than engaging with the country? If they're so confident about this monumental decision, and as I say, one of the biggest decisions, I would say, since Iraq or Suez, if they are so confident about what the solution they are going to provide is so good for our country, then they should be coming forward and putting the vote to the British people. Oliver Mundell.
Is Willie Rennie not reassured by Theresa May's commitment that the proposals will go before the UK Parliament?
Willie Rennie.
No. Not at all. Far from it. It's packed full of Conservative MPs who are going to tell exactly the Prime Minister exactly what she wants to hear. If they are so confident, put it before the British people. Let them have the final say. Of course, no, not just that. You've had to say. So if they are so confident, put it before the British people so they can have a say. Can I just deal with a couple of aspects of the SNP's paper published before Christmas? I mean, Ash Denham, who in a pretty good contribution, acknowledged the practical and technical difficulties of having a differentiated deal. Actually, I agree with her. All you have to do is look at page 35, paragraphs 153 to 155, which describes imports from the European single market. Now, if those three paragraphs aren't enough to put you off any differentiated deal, I don't know what is. because this is so complex. I don't understand it. I'm sure most people don't understand what it means, and it certainly won't be good for business. And I think that probably alone condemns this document and condemns the future. That's why I was disappointed that we haven't... Not just now. No, I'm in my last minute. I'm sorry. And that's why I would urge the SNP, if they are so much in favour of the European Union, and there's been some excellent contributions, I have to say, from Tom Arthur, his last contribution was excellent, some brilliant contributions. If they are so in favour of the European Union, then why do they not get behind the campaign that's got the momentum, the campaign for a Brexit deal referendum? We won in Richmond against the Conservatives. We are winning by-elections across the country because people do not want a hard Brexit. We've got the momentum. I would urge the SNP to come behind us so we can win that campaign. Thank you.
Thank you. Colin Daniel Johnson to wind up for the Labour Party.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This has been an important debate, and at times a highly charged debate, and I think the reasons for that are very clear. The stakes are incredibly high. But I think there's one thing that's clear, and I think one thing that all sides need to be mindful is that globalisation is with us. It's embedded in the way our economy works and operates. We cannot hide from that, we cannot control that, and we cannot alter any of these elements in isolation. And I would say that to both sides. We cannot simply put the world on hold while we negotiate trade deals, nor can we wait to come up with hypothetical scenarios which will never really come to pass or ever be realistic. Now, I'm in my first minute, if you wouldn't mind making some progress first and maybe later. I think Pauline McNeill put the quandary that faces us with Brexit very well. She described the issues that the EU presents us, but ultimately said that the protections it provides, the benefits of having wider trade, was what lent her vote towards the Remain side. So as we look towards this, I think it's important that we do try to retain access. Indeed, I think that the terms of the debate have been more broadly have been instructive. People have emphasised the importance of retaining access and retaining benefits, because the EU gives us admission to that globalised economy, but has done so while protecting workers' rights, putting in place social protections, meaning that we are not a part of a race to the bottom. So when we look to a future deal, while we look to our options, it's those elements of our trade and our relationship with Europe that we must seek to keep in place. So, of course, this debate is taking place within the context of new revelations. I think before Christmas, I think the Scottish Government's paper on options was very helpful and useful for exploring and expanding the space we're operating. But clearly, comments today from the UK Government are highly important. Indeed, a number of speakers have made that point, that it has provided clarity through what was perhaps a fog before. Again, Paul McNeill pointed this, indeed, Oliver Mundell. I think the points around the customs union are helpful, the fact that there has been some concession around that. While we may not like it, ruling out single market membership at least provides us with that degree of clarity. But it is important to recognise that Theresa May set out the importance of maintaining as free trade as possible. But perhaps most importantly are the transitional arrangements that she now concedes are important, because that gives us the opportunity to explore those options in full. I think a number of speakers, and indeed Willie Rennie highlighted this as well, Graham Day and Claire Adamson, highlighted the personal aspect of this, that the reality of Brexit is very much human. Human in two key ways. First of all, the anxieties that it has elicited in people. And I think it is important that as we progress, we do provide clarity as much as we can to people as we progress through this process. But also labour requirements. We need Europe provide workers in key sectors right the way across the board. Agriculture is within, but I would also like to highlight financial services, because I think it also highlights the complexity of this process. Financial services sector is massively important both to UK and Scotland. It's about 7% of GDP for both UK and Scotland. About 1 million people are employed across the UK in financial sectors, another 1 million in supporting functions. And Scotland has broadly those same shares, with 100,000 or so employed and a further 100,000 supporting. It generates a £70 billion trade surplus at a time where the UK trade deficit is £5 billion. That's how important it is. But it is utterly reliant in this country on passporting rights, because passporting is what allows financial institutions in this country to sell them into other parts of the EU without restriction, without impediment. And quite frankly, equivalence simply does not provide the same level of access, and I'll just take it in a moment, and certainly will not provide access to retail financial services, which will be damaging. So there is a danger that this may not be a big bang, but it certainly may well be a slow fizzle.
Stuart Stevenson.
Thank you. May I draw members' attention to my ownership of shares in Lloyds Bank. But the member refers to the international financial system and previously to globalisation. Does he accept that there would be a very good place for an ethical banking centre, which might be in the UK or might particularly be in Scotland, if we were able to deal with the secrecy of ownership and money transmission that contaminates so much of the global economy?
Daniel Johnson.
I thank the member for that point, and I agree with him on much of it, but I would actually lay that not so much the EU. I think the EU has done a good deal to open up transparency, and actually to something that the UK government needs to address, but maybe a point for another day. I think the Scottish government's motion today is helpful. I think it maintains the importance of exploring options, but also makes clear the reliance that we have in Scotland on being part of the wider UK for trade. Indeed, I think the paper published before the month made that explicitly clear in paragraph 95. And I would urge them to follow through on the sentiment there, where it explains that the Scottish Government seeks to work with the UK Government, maintaining the UK single market. It's this emphasis of options that's important. We must not have a binary choice of either choosing the UK or the EU. It simply cannot be cast as crudely as that. Indeed, I do appreciate the number of options, and I think Ash Denham and Ivan McKee did a good job of explaining what some of those may be. I think there are interesting options to be looked at EFTA. However, I think they are not without complications. EFTA does not permit the sub-states to join. And indeed, some of the examples that they gave, such as the Faroe Islands, are highly complicated. My understanding is the Danish government rejected that option on the basis that they could not expand the UK crown to encompass the option of a Faroe option. And indeed, I couldn't find the Faroese options paper on their website when I looked at it. And I would just like to briefly talk about deals. Many on the Conservative benches seem to treat deals as if they will happen instantly or quickly, or indeed that they are simply an equivalence to being in the EU. That just simply cannot be the case, given the size and scale of EU trade. And who would be holding the key cards? How quickly would that happen? We all know the controversies around TTIP and the erosion of social guarantees that would have that potentially entails. And if they think that was going to be controversial, could we even hope to guarantee social protections when we clearly would be at such a disadvantage in those negotiations? So just and briefly to conclude, we must explore all options, but we must be realistic. We must seek to influence the UK government, but we must be mindful of protection of jobs. So that is why we will be voting for the government amendment today, but mindful of the red line that we must protect our position in the UK before seeking false and unrealistic options within the EU. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Adam Tompkins to wind up for the Conservative Party.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In one of our very many debates on this subject, on the 14th of September last year, on these benches we sought to make three points, all of which I think have been exemplified or repeated in what the Prime Minister had to say earlier on today. The first point that we tried to make was that this debate cannot sensibly be reduced to a binary divide between hard Brexit and soft Brexit. It's not a binary divide. It's inevitably going to be messier than that. I know that there are those who are calling for a clean Brexit, but I don't think it's going to be particularly clean either. Our relationship with the European Union isn't clean now. I mean, we're in the European Union, but out of the Schengen zone. We are in the European Union, but we don't adopt the European Union's currency. Our relationship with the European Union is and always has been complex, and Brexit is also, I think, going to be complex. Not hard, not soft, but complex. So, for example, today on the customs union, I thought the Prime Minister very helpfully began to break that idea down. We're not going to be in the customs union or out of the customs union. The customs union is composed of various different components: the common commercial policy, the common external tariff, customs agreement with the rest of the European Union. These are different components that might require, not at the moment, these are different components that might require in the national economic interest different answers. The second point on the 14th of September that we sought to make, which I think bears repetition today, is that EEA membership, not at the moment, Mr. EEA membership is incompatible with the referendum result. EEA membership, the softest of all soft forms of Brexit, would require the United Kingdom to continue free movement of labour, as was made clear by Claire Adamson in her answer to my intervention earlier on, not taking back control of our borders. It would require the United Kingdom to submit to the full jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice, so not taking back control of our national legislation, of our sovereignty, of our laws. And it would continue, it would require a continued financial contribution to the European institutions, so not taking back control of our national finances. But none of this means, and again, the Prime Minister stressed this in her speech today, none of this means that we don't want the fullest, the greatest access to the single market. What the Prime Minister said was that we seek the greatest possible access to the EU single market through a new, comprehensive, bold and ambitious free trade agreement. We want, let me finish the point and then I'll happily give way. We want the freest possible trade in goods and services between Britain and the EU's member states. And indeed, in one of the quotations that we haven't heard SNP members reflect on in the debate this afternoon, what the Prime Minister is doing in these remarks is echoing something which Mike Russell himself said on two occasions last month. He said this: in the strictest sense, membership of the single market is only possible if you are a member of the EU. Well, Mr. Russell is right about that. And he's also said that our strategic objective, that's to say the Scottish Government's strategic objective, is involvement in the single market. Not membership of, but involvement in the single market. His words, not mine. And those are exactly the same as the words that the Prime Minister was using today. So I think if we could hear a little bit more about what the Scottish Government and the UK Government have in common in pursuit of their Brexit agendas, and a little bit less about what differentiates them, then I think we might all be to the profit. I give away to Mr. Lemon.
Richard Lockhead.
Can I thank the member for giving way, and in terms of reflecting quotations, given that his Scottish Party leader said in July, "I want to stay in the single market, even if a consequence of that is maintaining free movement of labour," will he clarify, is that still the Scottish Conservatives' position? If it is, will he get behind the Scottish Government's efforts to deliver that?
Adam Tompkins.
Scottish Conservative position now is exactly as I articulated it from these benches on the 14th of September 2016, which is exactly the point I've just been making, if the member would care to listen. What we want is the same as what the Prime Minister wants, and it's apparently the same as what Mike Russell himself wants, which is to recognise that membership of the single market requires membership of the European Union, and what we are in pursuit of is involvement in our view, the fullest possible, the greatest possible involvement in, access to and participation in the single market. That's been perfectly consistent for months from these benches, for all of the protestations to the contrary from the benches in the middle of this chamber. Now, I want to move, Presiding Officer, to the Scottish Government's paper published last month, which I said on the day that it was published that it's a thoughtful document and that it deserves to be taken seriously. Well, having read it now twice, I'm not quite so sure that it deserves to be taken quite as seriously as I did on that occasion. Let me identify, if I can, three problems with the Scottish Government's document. The first is the problem with EEA membership. And this is a problem which Ash Denham referred to in her speech earlier on this afternoon. Now, the Scottish Government said only 3 years ago that the argument that membership of the EEA is desirable because it allows members to gain access to the single market without having to adopt all of the regulations that full EU membership requires is simply wrong. Not my words, but the Scottish Government's words, in a document endorsed by the then Deputy First Minister, now First Minister, Nicola Sturgeon. So the odd thing about the Scottish Government's, not at the moment, the odd thing about the Scottish Government's pursuit of the EEA option is that it fails to meet Nicola Sturgeon's own tests, that in Ash Denham's words this afternoon, Scotland's voice must be heard. Because the whole point of EEA membership is that your voice is not heard in the making of the very laws which apply to you. And having invited a response from Ash Denham, I'm now very happy to give way to
it. Ash Denham.
Thank you for giving way, I appreciate it. Ruth Davidson wrote today that many of the nationalist requests have been recognised by the UK government. I wonder if the member could outline for us now what those concessions by the UK government will be.
Adam Tompkins.
Absolutely. Among the things that you have been calling on, among the things that the SNP have been calling for the last 7 months are that workers' rights should be protected. So what did the Prime Minister say about that today? What she said about this today was that as we translate the body of European law into our domestic regulations, we will ensure that workers' rights are fully protected and maintained. So there's an example of exactly what the SNP have been calling for, which was said by the Prime Minister just today. The second problem with the Scottish Government's paper published in December is the problem with the differentiated deal. And this is the really odd thing about the SNP's paper. It's a very odd paper for a nationalist document, that it fails to identify Scottish economic interests that are different from the economic interests elsewhere in the United Kingdom. The interests of Perthshire hill farmers are the same as the interests of hill farmers in Snowdonia or Yorkshire. The interests of our financial services industries in Glasgow and Edinburgh. I know Tom Arthur and others want to deny the importance of financial services to the Scottish economy, but he's wrong to do so. The interests of the financial services industry in Glasgow and Edinburgh are the same as the interests of the financial services industry in London. The interests of universities and higher education institutions such as St Andrews and Aberdeen are the same as those in Oxford and Manchester. So look, I'm all in favour of differentiated deals, but differentiated, not at the moment, but differentiated sector to sector, not nation to nation. Why? Because it's in the national economic interest to negotiate sector by sector. And the great omission from the Scottish Government's document is its failure to identify why or even how Scotland's economic interests are different from those of any other part of the United Kingdom. And the third problem with the Scottish Government's paper, thoughtful and deserving to be taken seriously, though it is. The third problem is with what it has to say about further devolution to Scotland. And when I read this section of the paper, presiding officer, I had a terrible case of deja vu, because this is copied and pasted from the SNP's failed and rejected submission to the Smith Commission a few years ago. This is devolution designed not to strengthen the United Kingdom, but to break up the UK's domestic market, which is why it is so important that the Prime Minister today said in her speech that as we go forward with our Brexit negotiations, our guiding principle must be to ensure that no new barriers are created between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, to living in Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, to doing business between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom. But at the same time, of course, there will be no re-reservations to Westminster. It doesn't follow that all of the powers that will be repatriated from Brussels to the United Kingdom will be held by Westminster and Whitehall. Some of them will be devolved to Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. And for all of these reasons, presiding officer, I support the amendment in Dean Lockhart's name.
Thank you. Can I call on Keith Brown to wind up the debate?
Firstly, presiding officer, can I thank members for their contribution during this important debate? I think there were some that certainly caught my eye: Claire Adamson, Polly McNeill, Tom Arthur, Lewis MacDonald, Ivan McKee, Daniel Johnson. I didn't agree with all of what he said. It was a very thoughtful contribution, in particular about the extent to which we are able to influence globalisation, and perhaps that's another subject for another day. Presiding officer, on the 23rd of June, Scotland voted emphatically to remain in the European Union, whilst England and Wales voted to leave. Now, I should say the point made by a number of Conservative members I accept. 38% of people in Scotland didn't vote that way, and I recognise and respect their choice. I only wish the Conservatives could show a smidgen of respect for the 62% that voted to remain in the EU, and that was missing here today. We are facing a situation that we've not seen before, with EU citizens in a strongly pro-European nation being taken out of the EU against their will. Since the vote on June the 23rd, the Brexit process at Westminster has been taken over, as has been mentioned by a number of members, by the right wing of the Tory party. And that's led to the Prime Minister's confirmation that she wants not just to leave the EU, but she wants the hardest of hard Brexits. There will be many Tories at Westminster who now believe they can do anything to Scotland and get away with it. And it's up to us today in this chamber, again, a point made by Tom Arthur, to make it clear that they cannot. We speak in the Scottish interest. In these circumstances, the Scottish Government is determined to show leadership and to protect our vital national interests. We have sought to build consensus around maintaining both Scotland and the UK's place in the single market. Yes, I will.
I'm Tompkins.
Minister for giving way. Can the Minister just explain how it is, how this is a definition of the hardest of hard Brexits. We want the freest possible trade in goods and services between Britain and the EU. That's what the Prime Minister said this morning, not the fictions of the Minister's imagination. These are her words. How is that a hard Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Because that bold assertion to free trade is assumed to be after you've exited the European Union and the single market. That is the Brexit that I'm talking about. And that's a hard Brexit. There's not one with transition. There's not one where we're going to try and keep some of the elements which are very beneficial to Scotland. It's a hard Brexit. It's not just the SNP that are saying this. Look at individual commentators. They'll all tell you it's a hard Brexit. Are all the TV and newspaper columnists lying about that? I don't think they are. I think they have the same understanding that I have. The Tories are after a hard Brexit. In these circumstances, it's down to the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to show leadership and to protect their vital national interests. We've sought to build that consensus. Indeed, Ruth Davidson, in this chamber, after the EU referendum, said, and these were her words, retaining our place in the single market should be the overriding priority. Why did not one single Tory member mention the words of their leader today? That's what she said. She called on the Scottish Government to protect our place in the single market, not mentioned by one Conservative member today. It's now time for the Tories to demonstrate that they'll put the overriding priority for Scotland ahead of the priority of the right wing of the Tory party. By contrast, we will set out constructive proposals, as we've done, in line with our commitment to explore all options to protect Scotland's interests. And Adam Tomkins fairly said that the document that we produced is not an overtly nationalist document. That was more or less his words. And of course it wasn't, because as the First Minister said, we have sought to reach compromise. We have tried to do that by the proposals that we put forward. If only Theresa May had sought to try and reach compromise as well. The Scottish Government set out its proposals, and we will continue to do that, and we'll also continue to show a willingness to compromise. In my office last week, I had a visitor, a woman that came in who had lived in Scotland for 17 years. She'd been married to a Scottish person, and she had three children. She was in tears for the entire time she was in my office because she thought she was either going to have to try and find the money to take out UK citizenship, provided she's passed that, or she would have to leave the country. Now, I'm not saying that that would necessarily happen to her, but that is a level of fear that's there. And I think it's appalling that today, when Theresa May had made that statement, she gave no comfort to the EU nationals who are sitting wondering about their future in this country. I think it's extremely important that the UK government respects the legitimate expectation of those who have exercised their treaty rights and chosen to make a life in Scotland. We have continually sought guarantees from the UK government on the immigration status and rights of all EU nationals currently residing in Scotland, and we do so again today. The Prime Minister pledged that the Scottish Government will be involved in the development of the UK-wide position. She said the Scottish Government's proposal should be given proper consideration, but we've not yet seen evidence that Scotland's voice is being listened to or our interests taken into account, and that has to change. Our proposals include our firm view, consistently expressed, that any outcome must include retaining membership of the single market in all its aspects, something which Ruth Davidson supported after the referendum decision. We should also support free movement of people and protection of rights, and close cooperation with EU partners on, for example, justice and research. The Scottish Government, just to repeat the point previously made, greatly values both the contribution that non-UK EU nationals bring to our economy and society and the benefits of freedom of movement enjoyed by our own citizens. Non-UK EU nationals are an important part of Scotland's future in terms of contributing to sustainable economic growth, mitigating the effects of democratic change and enriching our culture and our communities. Also, just as the UK is planning to take account of the particular circumstances of Northern Ireland, we've heard that in the Prime Minister's speech today, and Gibraltar, so we believe they should do the same for Scotland. Differentiated approaches, as we've heard from a number of speakers, are not unprecedented for the EU, and our aim is to be more fully integrated with the EU rather than, as most other cases of special arrangements, at the reverse. I'll give way to Dean Lockhart.
Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Mr. Brown. Does the Cabinet Secretary recognise that a number of his colleagues could only justify the differentiated approach set out in the document by reference to the position of the Faroe Islands, the Channel Islands and Liechtenstein? Is that really the limit of the SNP's ambitions for Scotland? Is that being stronger for Scotland? Scotland? Because Norway, the head of the EFTA Commission in Norway, has said that your position is not acceptable.
Cabinet Secretary.
President, sir, none of the members that mentioned those examples, and there were others like the Isle of Man, drew analogies between Scotland and those areas. They pointed out that differentiated approaches had been agreed, currently existed, so it is possible to achieve a differentiated approach. We don't underestimate, of course, the significant challenges that are associated with those options. But the paper which we produced sets out the basis how each of those challenges of a differentiated approach could be overcome if the political will exists to do so. So we have a different proposition from the UK Tory government. Now, both Richard Lockhead and Polly McNeill mentioned the Prime Minister's statement today when she said there are two ways of dealing with differences. You can respond by trying to hold things together by force, tightening a vice-like grip that ends up crushing into tiny pieces, the very things that you want to protect. Or you can respect difference, cherish it even. Cherish difference. That's what the Prime Minister said today. Surely, if you want to cherish difference, you must at least acknowledge the different approach of the people of Scotland who voted 62% to remain in the EU, the properly expressed through this Parliament and this Government views of the Scottish Government in terms of the settlement. Surely you should respect and cherish that difference, but we've seen nothing of that from the Conservatives in this chamber this afternoon. Those were the words, as I say, of the Prime Minister. I agree that Scotland voted differently, and I, for one, cherish that difference. Instead, the Tories that we have here have been parroting Tories in the UK government, and they always keep saying we must work together. What they mean is we must do as we're told.
Yeah.
We must work together with the UK government. We must do exactly as we're told by the UK government, and we're not going to do that. We are here to represent the people of Scotland. I should also say that a picture emerges from what the Prime Minister had to say of the hard Brexit beloved of Nigel Farage and now wholly embraced by the Tories in this chamber like new believers. But part of that particular picture portrayed by the Prime Minister is a specific contempt enunciated here today by the Scots Tories and UK ministers. That contempt leads them to ignore, to deride, to attack and to frustrate any expression of Scotland's aspirations. We thought the apogee of right-wing, and this is mentioned by a number of members today, the apogee of right-wing Toryism was in the 1990s, the 1980s. But this group of right-wing wannabe UKIPers that we have in this Parliament is reaching far beyond... is reaching far beyond even Margaret Thatcher. Remember, Margaret Thatcher, according to the Tories themselves, was the champion of the single market, even the architect of the single market. But we see a completely new breed of Conservatives, new not just since before they came into this Parliament, but changed since they came into this Parliament. Like Ruth Davidson expressing, demanding that the Scottish Government protect Scotland's place in the single market. And now, to a person, each one of them opposed to that, apparently. It can't be through conviction, it must be through expediency. I will do, yes.
Just your reference to UKIPers, does that mean the 400,000 SNP voters who voted to leave are also UKIPers?
Unlike Dean Lockhart, I've acknowledged the fact that 38% of people in Scotland didn't vote to remain. Would you please, for once, acknowledge that 62% of people in Scotland did choose to remain and show some respect for that position? It's also true to say that the potential for new market opportunities it's difficult to understand. What I don't understand is which country in the world is going to enter into a trade agreement with the UK where the rules are entirely what the British say it will be, and if there is any dispute about the rules, it will be sorted out by the British government. Those aren't my words, those are the words of former Tory Cabinet Minister Ken Clark. He doesn't understand how you're going to achieve these free trade agreements. As a government, we, by contrast, have been very clear about the benefits we receive from EU membership. The prosperity and the economic opportunities which membership of the single market brings to our nation, as well as the social protections it brings to our workers, the human rights it affords our people, and the important standards which protect our environment and keep our food and consumer goods safe, not to mention, of course, our water quality and water infrastructure. We are also a nation that believes strongly in European solidarity so that we can tackle today's global challenges such as climate change, terrorism and the refugee crisis together in solidarity. So the Scottish Government is determined to find solutions that will respect the voice and protect the interests of Scotland and to ensure the values of European solidarity, cooperation and democracy prevail. Presiding Officer, EU membership is part of Scotland's sense of itself. It's about the contribution that EU citizens make to Scotland and the contribution that people from Scotland are making throughout the EU. And it's about the idea that strong, independent nations can come together for the common good. This debate is at the heart hallmarks of the kind of country that we want to be. It can't, well, interestingly, on independence, I lost count when it got to 16 mentions of independence by the Conservatives. There were six from the Lib Dems. Who is obsessed by independence? There's only one group in this Parliament. It cannot be the vision of those on the right of the Tory party, the new UKIPers, who favour a low-wage, deregulated economy in which companies are forced to compile lists of foreign workers, even one proposal to try and charge £1,000 to employ an EU foreign national. Is that not a barrier to trade? Is that not a barrier to free movement of people? Is that not contempt for the rights of people? I think that it is. But it seems the Tory party now believes it can do anything to Scotland that it likes. It believes it can do that, no matter how damaging, and it believes it can get away with it. To presiding officer, our position, the position of the Scottish Government, is it's time we made clear they won't get away with it. I ask members to support the motion in my name.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on future relationship with Europe. The next item of business is consideration of motion number 3375 in the name of Liam MacArthur on the appointment of members of the Standards Commission for Scotland. And I would call on Liam MacArthur to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the corporate body.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I speak to the motion in my name on behalf of the SPCB appointment panel to invite members of Parliament to agree to the appointment of Michael McCormack and Tricia Stewart as members of the Standards Commission for Scotland. Under the Ethical Standards in Public Life, etc., Scotland Act 2000, members of the Commission are appointed by the SPCB with the agreement of this Parliament. The role of the Standards Commission is to encourage high ethical standards in public life, and it does this by promoting and enforcing the codes of conduct for councillors and members of devolved public bodies. The SPCB sat as a selection panel on 12 December 2016. I chaired the panel alongside Gordon MacDonald and David Stewart. On behalf of the SPCB, I would like to thank Louise Rose, the independent assessor who oversaw the process and has confirmed by way of a validation certificate that the appointment process conformed to good practice and that the nominations are made on merit after a fair, open and transparent process. From a very strong field of candidates, as I say, we are seeking the agreement of Parliament to appoint Michael McCormack and Tricia Stewart as members of the Standards Commission. I would also like to thank, on behalf of the SPCB, the outgoing members, Ian Gordon and Matt Smith, for their services to the Commission and wish them well for the future. Turning to the candidates themselves, we believe that Michael McCormack and Tricia Stewart will bring to the Standards Commission high levels of integrity and discretion and a strong commitment to encouraging and promoting high ethical standards in public life. I'm sure that the Parliament will want to wish both Michael and Tricia every success in their new roles. Presiding Officer, I move the motion in my name.
Thank you. And the question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are five questions to be put as a result of today's business. And I wish to remind members that if the amendment in the name of Dean Lockhart is agreed, then the amendment in the name of Willie Rennie falls. The first question is the amendment 3427.3 in the name of Dean Lockhart, which seeks to amend motion 3427 in the name of Michael Russell, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 3427.3 in the name of Dean Lockhart is yes 31, no 91. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 3427.1 in the name of Lewis MacDonald, which seeks to amend the motion in the name of Mike Russell, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The next question is that Amendment 3427.2 in the name of Willie Rennie, which seeks to amend Motion 3427 in the name of Michael Russell, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 3427.2 in the name of Willie Rennie is yes, 5, no, 117. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that motion 3427 in the name of Michael Russell, as amended, on protecting Scotland's interests and negotiating our future relationship with Europe, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. We'll move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion number 3427 in the name of Michael Russell as amended is yes, 86, no, 36. There were no abstentions, and the motion as amended is therefore agreed. The final question is that motion 3375 in the name of Liam MacArthur on behalf of the corporate body be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. That concludes decision time. We'll now move to members' business in the name of Stuart Stevenson, and we'll just take a few moments for members to change seats.